Thursday, June 16th, 2022. Ermanni and Edwards, bottom line, Woodward Sports Network. Ryan Ermanni, Braylon out today. Stick is in the house.
That's been a fun week, hasn't it, Ryan?
My man, Stick, always ready to get the call. You know, Braylon is attending to a business affair.
In Washington, D.C.,
I saw. A pre-scheduled meeting. He will be back later tonight, but not in time for the show to start. And then, of course,
I do have a little gripe, though.
Uh-oh.
A little gripe with y'all.
Okay.
So I was on the show Monday. I was on the show Tuesday. Yesterday I wasn't on, and Isaiah Thomas calls. Like, I would have loved to talk to Isaiah Thomas.
Unbelievable. And I wish Unreal. It was pointed out that we have Isaiah Thomas, like a hologram fathead, or what would you call that?
Yeah, it's just a big sticker, fathead sticker.
Yeah, fathead sticker.
Yep.
We've got Steve Yzerman.
Yep.
Barry Sanders, Isaiah Thomas.
And Alan Trammell.
And Alan Trammell.
Legends.
How about that? How cool is that?
And one of the holograms called in yesterday. How awesome. Like, honestly, I was sitting at home. I saw the tweet come out that, Isaiah Thomas called into the bottom line. And, man, like, when you talk about Detroit sports and you talk about legitimizing what Woodward Sports is and how it's actually affecting Detroit sports culture, when Isaiah Thomas is in tune with what you're doing and calls in to talk to you, that's pretty effing special.
Well, Stick, I am going to do something for you today.
Uh-oh.
Okay? Mm-hmm. Since you are here today.
Yes, sir.
And actually, we'll give Tom Mazawey all the credit for this. But since you are here today and could not talk to Isaiah Thomas yesterday, how would you like to talk to Jim Leyland today?
Man, I got goosebumps.
How do you not?
Like, Jim Leyland, to me, is the antithesis of what baseball should be going forward, what it was in the past. Like, he is the perfect baseball guy. He smokes cigarettes in the dugout. He yells at his player. Like, the way my dad taught me baseball is Jim Leyland.
Without question. Actually, Tom Mazawey, good afternoon to you, by the way. Get the pleasantries out of the way. Get the pleasantries out of the way.
Good. He's doing his Leyland impression.
That's your impression? That's the worst impression I've ever heard in my life of Jim Leyland. Can I tell you a Jim Leyland story real quick?
I could tell you a million from Hazel Park Raceway.
Really?
Oh, God,
you love the horses?
Oh, they used to hang with him
at
Hazel
Park. Him and Gino love the ponies. But so it was, I don't remember. It was spring training. I couldn't tell you what the year was. But Dimitri Young had just left the Tigers or something like that. He left the Tigers and was bad-mouthing the organization a little bit. Like, they didn't handle my diabetes diagnosis well and this, that, and the other thing. And I can't remember if it was Jason Beck. But Jason Beck's name comes to mind. He's the Tigers beat writer for MLB.com. But his name comes to mind, and if it wasn't Jason Beck, I apologize. If it was somebody else, I'll give you the credit. But they asked the question of Dimitri Young, and they said, Skip, Dimitri Young said that the Tigers organization did not handle his diabetes diagnosis properly, or something like that. And Jim Leyland, sitting on the desk, this is in Lakeland.
Is there anyone more authentic than Jim Leyland, by the way?
Sitting on the desk like this.
Pull the mic towards you.
I can't.
There you go.
Okay. Sitting here, he's looking and he says, diabetes. Diabetes. And it was the funniest. And then he went on and said, we did that for Dimitri Young. But it was the funniest thing I had ever seen in my life. Diabetes. So anytime I see a diabetes commercial.
It's Wilford Brimley and Leyland.
Oh, my God. Anytime I see a diabetes commercial, I automatically say,
diabetes. Diabetes.
Maybe that wasn't the coolest story for you, but it was for me. But I'm telling you, there aren't too many people that are better, to talk to listen to, than Jim Leyland. He's just the greatest. And he was here over the weekend. It was Summer Bash just recently here. So he was here and up to date on all things Tigers. Also today, we're going to talk to Mark Kestecher.
Ooh.
He will have the call on ESPN Radio Game 6 tonight. The Golden State Warriors look for their fourth world title in this era, in this, what do you call it? With this team, I guess you'd say.
Yeah, with this dynasty, if you want to call them that.
And they are a dynasty.
They are.
If they win tonight, I think they're definitely a dynasty.
They're still a dynasty.
It's crazy that they remained a dynasty, too, even after losing, like, a KD. You know, because they were good before KD got there. Then they were almost unbeatable when he was there. And now they're back to winning championships. Like, it's interesting. Most teams that have a dynasty, you have that core together, and they don't leave. This core broke up, came back together. They dealt with injuries, and they're still here fighting. So hats off. It's going to end tonight, too, Maz. We're going to get in this debate. It's ending tonight.
That's fine, buddy.
Kestecher,
you can have your opinion.
And Maz, you're the play-by-play guy.
I am.
You're the announcer guy.
I am.
And we have our list of favorites. We do, and there's no doubt about it. But Mark Kestecher is as good as there is.
He's a stay-in-the-car guy. You stay in your car when he's calling a game and it's close. He is one of the best. And I want to thank Al Rosenberg, the engineer to the stars. We are lucky to have him.
How many years has he been doing that, Al Rosenberg?
40 years?
Probably has been at every major sports championship, sports moment that you know. If you think of a sports moment in your mind in a championship series,
he's there.
In all sports, it's like Al Rosenberg has been there.
He's my secret weapon.
Yeah.
He's my secret weapon.
What a guy.
I call him. If I need somebody, Al gets me up. Because he's with the best of the best at every event. If you're looking on television,
you see him.
Al on the front row.
Yeah, you absolutely
see him. And he does
the
Lion games every game. He does the Tiger games. Does them all. He's just tremendous. So tonight, ESPN Radio, Mark Kestecher. On the call.
And we'll also get you some, hopefully make you some money. Scottie G is going to join
he's
us.
He's hot.
Scottie G is hot. I don't even know what the number is tonight. Do you guys know what the number is tonight for the Celtics?
I guess Celtics by 2.5.
Is that a guess or
that's
you know?
That's a guess. That's an absolute guess.
Can you pull that up, Stick?
Yeah, I'm looking at it right now.
Let's get a look at it.
Go to mybookie.com.
Look at that. He's even doing the sponsors. MyBookie and Odds Trader. We'll get that in for you as well. By the way, if you are watching on YouTube, we certainly appreciate it. Go ahead and hit that like button for us. Subscribe to Woodward Sports as well.
I bet you Jim Leland will know the number.
Boston is -4.
Boston -4. Okay. So you were off, Maz.
A little bit.
Over under 210.
And I think that's the prevailing thought, I think, from everybody. And again, Vegas doesn't. They're usually fairly close on the number.
Yeah.
Everybody anticipates, not everybody, most people anticipate this going to a seventh grade game.
Yeah. No, Warriors by like 20 tonight. That's what I'm
predicting. You think so?
I mean, it's got to be so gut-wrenching for the Celtics to watch Steph Curry have arguably the worst game of his playoff career, and they still couldn't even come within 15. I mean, what else can you point to? How can we beat these guys? They had the worst game, and they still beat us. How do you draw that up as the coach? How do you get your team motivated to be like, hey, if we shut down Steph Curry, we're going to win this game? It's like, coach, no, we just did that, and we didn't win.
Well, selfishly, I am rooting for a Celtics win because I don't think anything could cap off a Father's Day other than a Game 7 of the NBA Finals, right? I mean, isn't that what we all want? And I hope we get it.
I don't think Adam Silver's well enough yet to be there for the trophy presentation. He's still got the COVID, so yes, it'll be Sunday.
Who's officiating tonight?
Still got,
that's a whole thing,
still
too.
Got the COVID,
the COVID,
as you say.
The COVID.
The vid.
By the way, I wanted to get this. This was trending earlier today and late last night, and I have to make mention of this off the top because it's almost the dumbest thing I've ever seen in my life. Vince McMahon, and this is the tweet from CNN. Vince McMahon, the CEO of World Wrestling Entertainment, being investigated by the company's board for agreeing to pay a secret $3 million settlement to a former employee he allegedly had an affair with, according to a Wall Street Journal report. Now, this is... Then all of a sudden you saw the name Trish Stratus trending on Twitter. Look, this was not an in-ring person. This was somebody behind the scenes. It was something, I believe, an assistant, whatever the case. This is mind-blowing to me that this is even news. There is zero doubt this is true. And there's probably many more of them. Vince McMahon has probably slept with every single female employee, specifically in ring. No, I shouldn't say that out loud. But, I mean, this guy has been at it for 40 years, and it's no secret he's a bit of a womanizer.
To me, it's much to do about nothing, though.
Like, they know this.
It's two adults.
How is this a news story?
Yes, he's cheating on his wife. That's a bad thing, right. Of course. But if it's two consenting adults having an affair together,
well, she
and he's
was
just
suing
paid,
she was suing him because of like I don't remember what.
But
the
he paid her to
for.
Shut the hell up
yeah.
about the affair, and,
right?
And that happens all the time, you know. And it's like the have you ever seen the movie Four yeah. Brothers? Like you don't pay a prostitute.
Hey man, look.
You pay him to leave. That's why you pay him. You pay him to be quiet.
Leave Vince alone, man. Leave Vince alone out there. I mean, guy's just trying to run a business out here. Hey, we're going to take a break. Come right back. When we do, we're going to have the former manager of the Detroit Tigers, Jim Leyland. But first, a message from the Folding Warehouse.
That's a you, Mazawey.
That's me. It's in Hamtramck. You guys know it. It's my favorite game. It's football and bowling put together by my man, Chris Hutt, his wife, Noni Hutt. Great hosts. They will tell you what to do and how to play it. It's two ways to play. $12 unlimited open play or a private lane reservation for 10 or 12 of your closest friends. You could have it on your own. 2 hours, $120. The bar is always open and it's high, as Marty Morningweg used to say. Over 100 beers they offer and the $2 mystery beer machine. Name your drink and they've got it at their multiple full bars. Bring your own food in or have it delivered. Get your foal on at the Folding Warehouse. For more information, check out foldingwarehouse.com.
It's a great day to get some Sensrine in your life. Okay. There it is. Sensrine, here we go. Gotta grab the cranberry. Oh, wait, it's 2 for $4. Gotta double up with the classic as well. Sensrine World, baby. Sensrine, available at select Kroger's. And if you want to know how, go to @sensrineworld.com. You get dope like me. You know what? Why wait? Great taste guaranteed.
Strawberry Fest is back at Big Boy. We brought back some of the classic breakfast items like the strawberry French toast, hot cakes, and waffle. If you're not feeling breakfast, try our new strawberry bacon chicken wrap. Crispy chicken wrap, nacho wrap, or strawberry salad. The perfect recipe for springtime. And don't forget to grab dessert, including our berry delicious strawberry pie for only $1.99 with the purchase of $7.99 or more at participating Big Boy locations.
We are the network for Detroit.
By Detroiters.
Welcome to the Woodward Sports Network.
Planet Fitness is inviting all high school teens between the ages of 14 and 19 to work out for free all summer long via the High School Summer Pass, which ends August 31st. Planet Fitness is home of the judgment-free zone where you can work out in a non-intimidating, judgment-free atmosphere. Join today in-club or online at www.planetfitness.com. Planet Fitness, where your fitness is essential.
Right back here on Woodward Sports Network. Glad to have you along with us, Ryan Ermanni. Braylon is out today, and he just sent me a text, actually. He's like, you guys got Leyland on, and I'm not here? So funny. I mean, everybody loves Jim Leyland. Stick sitting in for Braylon today, and, of course, Tom Mazawey. Let's bring him in, the former manager of the Detroit Tigers, current special advisor, special assistant to the Detroit Tigers. Jim Leyland, how you doing, Jim?
Guys, I'm doing all right. How are you?
Doing fantastic. Jim, first off, you were in town at the park over the weekend. Everybody loves you. I mean, when they see you, Jim, Tigers fans love you. What do you feel about the fan base here? What are your thoughts on the fans just being so beloved by the organization?
Well, yeah, I don't know that they all love me, but I do think that I had a good rapport with the fans, but you got to remember the players pretty much played good the entire 8 years I was there. Not every single year, but pretty much every single year we went to the postseason a couple times, a couple World Series. A lot of them disappointed, obviously, like us, so we didn't get that final straw. But I don't know. I felt like I had a pretty good rapport with them. I responded to people. I wasn't afraid to talk to people. I wasn't afraid to. You know, tell them that, hey, I messed up, or this is why I did something. You can agree or disagree with it, but I'm not going to argue with you about it. You want to know why I did something, bunted, or did whatever I did. I'll tell you why I did it, and then you can make your own judgment, but I'm not going to argue with you. And I think people appreciated that. You tried to reach out to the fans, and I think on my radio show, I always tried to reach out to the fans, and I tried to let them know as much as I could possibly let them know, you know, so that I think it's important for your fans to feel part of it. I think when you reach out to them and they reach out to you a little bit, I think they actually feel part of the ball club, and I think that's very healthy. So I loved it there. I enjoyed it very much, and of course, I still enjoy working for the organization.
Jim, and the Chicago White Sox were just here, and just looking at Tony La Russa in the other dugout, he's 77, you're 77. Do you miss it? Do you miss any part of the day-to-day grind, being in the clubhouse, anything to do with managing?
Yeah, I miss the competition, and I miss the players. I don't miss, you know, all the travel and all that type of stuff. But, yeah, I certainly miss that part. You know, there's some of the other stuff, you know, getting there at noon and, you know, not getting out of there till midnight every day and then, you know, getting in places at 4 o'clock in the morning, playing the next day. You know, I don't know that I could do that anymore. I actually feel like, you know, I could step in a dugout and manage a game today. I don't think I'd have any problem with that. But whether it was good or bad, I think I could manage the game. But all the other stuff that goes with it. But I miss the players and I miss the competition. But that's pretty much it.
Jim, thanks for joining us. My name's Stick. Been a huge fan of yours. I was talking before you got on just how I love the old school baseball mentality that you had with this team and the toughness that you brought with them. And obviously with the position that the Tigers are in right now, kind of similar to when you got brought into the organization for the first time. What do they got to do? What's the first step that they need to tackle to get out of this slump?
Well, you know, I think some of it's a little misleading. I think that they did a lot of stuff to get out of this slump when in the offseason. They went out and got the players we wanted. Chris Illich spent $300 million. You know, it kind of irritates me when they get on Chris Illich and Al Avila. They went out and got the players they wanted. Chris Illich spent $300 million. We got a great manager. And, you know, right now, for whatever reason, things just haven't, you know, some of the guys we got and some of the guys we had that got pretty good backs on their bubblegum card, you know, they're pretty good statistics have over their career, for whatever reason, just to have not performed up to their capability. And I think they will. I certainly like the players that we have. I think they will. But up to this point, you know, you're seeing a lot of downside from guys that have done very, very well in the past. Grossman good last year. Baez is a great player, great talent. Scope, you know, Candelaria, Meadows, you could go on and on and on. I mean, you know, Meadows and Grossman don't have a home run. I mean, you know, I understand it's not that easy, but, and that's not being critical. That's just pointing out that, you know, we figured obviously a little bit better than that. So I think when those guys start performing the way they're capable, I think we're fine. You know, we got a little unfortunate thing with Rodriguez who's missed some time now. We've had a couple of injuries, but everybody's had injuries. I think AJ, probably by his own admission, was embarrassed, you know, to have to pitch a position player, you know, three innings, I think is a little much. You know, one inning from time to time, you kind of get a kick out of you move to the next day. And I certainly understood why AJ did it. He's trying to, you know, if he's got a chance to win the game tonight, he's got to have his relievers ready. But, you know, I think he was probably embarrassed about that. So I think that we really did kind of get the players that the organization wanted. And, you know, I think AJ and the coaches and the scouts and myself, we got guys that that we wanted. And Chris certainly spent the money, opened up the pocketbook. We just haven't performed. And I think we will. I'll be shocked if we don't. But I know that AJ is probably very disappointed right now. And rightfully so, and he's probably scratching his head as to, hey, I guess I got to push some different buttons.
Talking to Jim Leyland, the former manager of the Detroit Tigers. Jim, just talking about this team right now in the offense. I went back this morning and looked at some numbers. 62 games played. In 31 of those games, the team has scored 2 runs or less. I mean, it seems like when it's going bad, it's really going bad. What do you say to the guys as a manager How do you get just one guy to string a couple of good days together?
Well, you just got to, you know, stay on them about grinding it out, and you know, and you turn it around. You don't. There's no tricks to it. There's no secrets. It's just working hard plus working smart. You know, I think you gotta do both. You can work hard, but if you don't work smart, you don't accomplish stuff. If you work smart but you don't work hard, you don't accomplish stuff. So I think, I'm sure they're working. I don't think there's any question about that. We just, like I said, so far we just haven't hit on those guys that we expect to do better than they've done. They're very talented. They've shown it in the past. So you have to expect that's gonna happen. Like, you know, the other day, I think it upsets me a little bit that people on Alavila so bad. I think it's unfair. And the reason I say that is I was listening to it on the way home from the game the other day, and I left a little early to get back to Ohio. And a guy came on and said, yeah, it was Vila. They didn't beat out. They wanted Correa. They didn't get Correa. The guy didn't have his facts straight. They offered Correa a huge contract. Huge contract. Like in the neighborhood of $270, $280 million. He turned it down. So I think you need to, you know, get the facts straight before you just throw it out there and criticize. I feel bad for it. I mean, Al hasn't done everything right. I didn't do everything right when I was there. I'm sure AJ hasn't done everything perfect since he's been there. But at the same time, I just think that's unfair criticism on Al Avila. They went out and made a big push for Correa. He chose not to take the long, long-term contract with us. So, you know, I think you gotta look into it a little bit more before you just start criticizing.
Jim, whether it's the fans or radio hosts or TV hosts or newspaper writers or whoever, when there's chirps like that and people are calling for this guy's head and that guy's head, what impact, if any at all, does that have on a clubhouse, on an organization?
Yeah, I don't think it bothers the players. I really don't. I think it's, nobody likes to hear that. You know, we can all say we don't listen to those things and we don't read the paper. But we do read the paper. We don't necessarily listen to those because we're working when that stuff's going on a lot. But somebody tells you about it. You know, if somebody's on you and they're on you hard. And you know what's going on. And as an individual, you certainly don't feel good about it. But I don't think it affects the players. It doesn't affect the way you go about your job. Hey, you know, we're open season on criticism. When you're a professional coach or a manager, and that's the way it should be. You want your fans interested. You know, and if they have opinions and everything, that's fine. As long as they're fair, I think that's very, very fine. I don't think there's anything wrong with that at all. I think it's good. I think it's healthy. I feel like they're part of the team.
Well, Jim, but one of your former players, Joel Zumaya, who's actually one of my favorite players, the last professional jersey I've ever bought, he's been going nuts on social media, and he came out with a post today talking about canning people, starting with Al Avila, and then he ends it with P.S. If you're going to have a players-only closed-door meeting and not have anyone get heated during the conversation, then obviously no one cares enough to change. Do you know how many of these meetings took place during the 2006 season? We had plenty of them, and I'm going to say all of them were very exciting. Half of them, Jim Leyland comes in storming through the doors like an angry troll ripping our asses. Do you think that's what the Tigers need right now? An angry troll to rip their asses?
No, I don't. I think I think Joel's a little bit out of line on some of his comments. He's certainly entitled to those comments. But, you know, this, when you're management, you know, you're either the beneficiary or the victim of your player's performance. And right now, a lot of good players that we have, this is not a criticism, this is a fact. A lot of the good players we have are not performing up to their capabilities. And if they don't, we will not win. And they will be calling for somebody's head. I get that. But I think every once in a while, you got to say, hey, you know, the game belongs to the players. So when you do good, you give the credit to the players. And when you don't do good, you put it on your shoulders that you have to do a better job of managing or whatever it may be. I understand all that. But at the end of the day, we got very talented players that up to this point have not performed to their capabilities or the history of their career. I think they will. And when they do, I think we can take off. But if they don't do that, we're in trouble.
Hey, Jim, I want to ask you about Spencer Torkelson. Do you think he could use a stint in the minors? I mean, the first guy that I think of is Max Scherzer, is a guy who went down there for a couple of weeks, and you know, he's a freaking Hall of Famer, Max Scherzer. Do you think Torkelson could use a couple of weeks in the minors to get his head straight?
Confidence that'd be a better back. Question for AJ. Yeah. I mean, that'd be a better question for AJ. I think my personal opinion is that it would not hurt him. I don't think it's necessarily something that you have to do, but I do not think it would hurt him to go down and get some at-bats. He's getting a lot of at-bats to the big leagues. He's been a little fun. But if there's anything that I've ever been sure of, Spencer Torkelson is going to be a star in this league at some point. He has really got a solid foundation for hitting. He's a little off now. He's not getting the ball in the air quite as much as maybe he has in the past, and maybe a little bit of minor league career and certainly in college. So I think that'll all count. This guy is going to be a star, and there's very few guys that go up that big league as a rookie. There's a lot of rookies that are struggling this year. You just don't go up to that league and tear it up, particularly the way they use their pitching nowadays. The starter's only in there for maybe one or two times around at the most. You're seeing a bunch of different relievers come in. It's very difficult right now to hit in the big leagues because you're not seeing the same guy very often, and everybody's coming out of the bullpen pretty much throwing 96, 97. Look at the Tiger bullpen. It's one of the best in all of baseball. So I think he's fine. I don't think it would hurt him to send him down, but I don't necessarily think that you have to send him down.
Hey, Jim, Tom Mazawey, thanks a million for coming on. You never say no to me. We appreciate it. Miss our days at Hazel Park Raceway. Miss that place.
More than you know,
I miss that place. But I'll tell you, a guy they miss, and no one's even talking about him anymore, is – it's Akil Baddoo, and I feel for that kid. I mean, that guy was a spark plug last year. He came up here like a shooting star, and he's disappeared. And I feel, I don't know what the hell happened to that guy. Can you explain what happens to a player like that, and do you think he could regain what he had last year?
Yeah, I think he's a very talented player. I think he'll be back at some point. He had a little bit of an injury problem down at Toledo. But I think he'll be back at some point. I still think he has a chance to be a very, very solid major league player. Stuff happened fast for him last year. It was kind of an unbelievable story. I've never seen anything like it.
No.
Some kid that only played in A-ball come up and tear the big leagues up. I think he hit 14 home runs.
Yeah.
I mean, that's unheard of. It was just unbelievable. So I definitely think he'll be back. I think he's a good player. He's strong. He can run. I think he's got a loud sound in his bat. I think, don't forget about him. I think he'll be back at some point, and I think he's going to end up being a good player. But
that's
people make
hear.
Adjustments to you,
yeah.
And then you got to readjust.
That's good to hear. That could be huge. And now let's go to Riley Green. And well, when this kid finally comes up, it's going to be a lot of pressure on him here, especially if he comes up here and is the player that everyone expects him to be. And that kid in Baltimore, Reichman, this is his first home run. Last night, as a matter of fact. Now, Riley Green is the number one prospect. He comes up here. If he starts hitting, he can maybe be that kid here that maybe everyone else can get on board. But it's a kid. I don't know. How does that work? Is it too much pressure for this guy?
I don't think so much as the pressure. I just think that it's a maturing process. And Riley Green is going to be an outstanding major league player for a long time. I think he'll be an all-star player at some point. But you got to remember, Riley Green hasn't really played AAA that much.
Right.
And so, I mean, he's just a baby out of high school, two or three years. So, I mean, don't expect Riley Green to come up there and carry the Tigers. That's not going to happen. He's going to do fine. He's going to have some really nice days. He's going to have some really tough days. Until he gets settled in. Him and Torkelson are both in the same boat, in my opinion. Even Baddoo has to readjust a little bit. So those three guys are the real deal. And this Green kid is really a good, good-looking player. But, you know, I think we're asking too much if we, you know, we're waiting Riley Green to come to the big leagues. And I think that's wonderful. And it's exciting. But don't be disappointed if he just doesn't tear it up right away. That's
right.
Not going to happen.
And one last one for me. Tarek Skubal has come up here and done wonderful things. Who does he remind you of, and what do you think he can give the Tigers going down the line?
Well, he doesn't remind me of anybody. I like each player to have his own identity.
Yeah.
I really like Skubal. I thought he has a great delivery. The delivery does remind me a little bit of Koufax's delivery, to be honest with you.
Wow.
But that's delivery. I'm certainly not comparing him to Kopech, but this kid's a real deal. There's no question about it. He's a real deal. He's got a good feel for pitching. He has outstanding stuff. He's got that extra gear if he needs to tune it up or turn it up. So, yeah, he's the real deal. You know, we'd love to have a couple more like him. And that was just a great job on the amateur scouts part. They got him in the 12th round out of Seattle somewhere. And, I mean, just a terrific, terrific scouting job.
Hey, Jim, we can't thank you enough for your time. I do have one final two-part question. Number one, you have managed some of the best players in the history of this game. Barry Bonds, Miguel Cabrera, Justin Verlander.
Max Scherzer.
Sneaks out. A, do you believe Barry Bonds should be in the Hall of Fame? And two, and I know you're probably not going to talk about yourself, but you too belong in the Hall of Fame. Do you expect to get that call? What would that call mean to you if you got that in January?
Well, that would be, you know, that would be great, obviously. But, you know, I leave that to somebody else. You know, I think you could make a case for me. You could probably make a case not for me. But I'll leave that to somebody else. That's really, you know, it would be wonderful to happen. But my career is what it is. You know, I'm going to go on regardless whether I get in or not. So I think, you know, it's just what it is. You're at the mercy of the voters, and we'll see what happens. But I definitely think Barry Bonds belongs in the Hall of Fame. And I think, to be honest with you, even the people that vote against Barry Bonds, I think they believe that he belongs in the Hall of Fame. But because of their suspicions, they're not putting him in. But I don't think it means that they don't think he's a Hall of Fame player. I think most everybody has to think Barry Bonds is a Hall of Fame player. But because of some suspicions, some people are not going to vote for him. And certainly that's their right. That's their privilege. It's a privilege to vote for the Hall of Fame. And they have the right to vote however they see fit.
Jim, one last thing on Barry Bonds. Can you just go over that tirade you did in Pittsburgh at spring training one more time with us, please?
Well, that was kind of my benchmark in Pittsburgh, and I'm not very proud of that, to be honest with you, because it was just a misunderstanding with Bill Verdon, and I got involved, and it was kind of a misunderstanding. We talked about it. We laugh about it now. More people make more stuff of that than we do. We kind of laugh about it now, but it was just a misunderstanding, and, you know, having it at the wrong time, and, you know, it just caught me and caught him a little bit. And but, you know, it really wasn't as big a deal as it seemed to be, other than the fact that, you know, I wish it would have never been on TV, but that was my fault. The TVs were there. You know they're there, but I wasn't thinking about it. I snapped, and he snapped, and, hey, hopefully that's just two big boys having a disagreement, and that's the way I look at it.
Us baseball fans loved it, though.
Yeah, absolutely loved it. And I know we asked you earlier about coaching again. Even if it's – I'm not specifically talking about Detroit, but you said you didn't like it because of the travel. Would you ever take a GM role?
No, I'm done. I like what I'm doing. I go to spring training. I see all the games. I evaluate the club and give an opinion if AJ or Al ask it. I go to see – I was just in Toledo watching our AAA club. I'm going to Erie next week. I really like that. I come up to Detroit for some functions once in a while, but I pretty much stay away. It's not my show anymore. I don't want to hang around. I don't want to be one of those guys that hangs around. So I'm very happy doing what I'm doing, and still enjoy working for the Tigers as well as doing a little work with the commissioner.
Well, we're going to hopefully we get that Hall of Fame call in January, Jim. You certainly deserve it. And those writers, man, I'll tell you, we're at their mercy for a lot of things, aren't we?
There's something.
Well, they got a job to do, a lot of responsibility, and I'm sure they'll make a choice that they feel is right, and that's fair enough for me.
Amen to that. Jim Leyland, we cannot thank you enough for your time, sir. Thank you so much.
You got it.
All right. The great Jim Leyland.
How awesome was that?
I mean, absolutely a Hall of Famer in our book, right?
Damn, I forgot to ask him if he had Mo Donegal in the Belmont.
The numbers, listen, the numbers bear out. I mean, he belongs in the Hall of Fame.
Absolutely.
Period. And, you know, it's funny because Barry Bonds did say, he's like, that moment really helped me in my career to understand that this is the manager, and I can't be doing that. I can't be talking to coaches and managers like that.
Well, yeah, I mean, how many people in his life to that point ever talked to Barry Bonds like that?
Yeah.
You know, when you're a star athlete, you're pampered all the way from Little League through high school, through college, then you get to the pros, and, yeah, sometimes it takes a Jim Leyland, a man like Jim Leyland with a little bit of oomph in them to put you in your place. And I'm glad. I love that. I know he said he doesn't love that video, that it's out there. I love that that's out there. So thank you, Jim, for that moment.
And I think it helped make Jim Leland as well.
The aura.
Absolutely. Guys, we're going to take a break. We'll talk more Tigers in just a little bit. But first, a message from Les Stanford Chevrolet Cadillac. No secret that new cars are hard to come by, but they are available at Les Stanford. You got to make a plan, though. Allocation coming in for lease or purchase of new vehicles. Les Stanford also has over 350 pre-owned cars on their lot right now. All makes, all models, all year. Some with less than 500 miles on them. So they're like brand new. For more, visit lesstanford.com. lesstanford.com. Find new roads.
Six dark corners, a driveway and a patio, five windows that could become doors. Every house has unique security challenges. Guardian Alarm has more tech, more team, and more ways to help keep them all safe. Get a professionally designed and installed security and smart home system from Guardian Alarm. Sign up today and get a free video device. Guardian Alarm. Smart right from the start. Call 1-800-STAY-OUT.
Yo, Scott from the Woodward Bet Show. Hey, as my shirt says, I don't gamble, I invest in the outcomes of the games. And if you've been following along, you know we've been kicking them sportsbooks butts lately. So make sure you guys are following along over there at the YouTube page at 4:30. And also, hey, you guys got to make sure you download my favorite app, OddsTrader.com. It's got live scoring, play-by-play updates, and it's the best place to check all the odds at the sports books right in the palm of your hand. Hey, let's get back to that winner. We're going to roll with the Rangers today against our Tigers. Tigers stink. Rangers have covered the last 30 out of 46 on the run line. That's where we're going to go with Rangers minus run and a half. OddsTrader.com. Woodward Bets. Check it out.
You have an opinion? Make sure it's seen and heard.
Corner. Jumper.
Tweet us, hop on the YouTube chat, slide in the DMS at Woodward Sports on all social media.
Our friends at Alta Equipment know that when it comes to getting your job completed on budget and on schedule, uptime matters. That's why Alta Equipment has partnered with the biggest names in construction. With the most diverse rental fleet in Michigan, there's nothing your project can throw at you that Alta can't handle. So give them a call at 844-GO-TO-ALTA today. Alta Equipment. Where uptime matters.
Uptime!
Stick, I thought you really had a great question for Leland, and that was, you know, in regards to the Joel Zamaya, and Leland does believe that Joel Zamaya is speaking out of turn.
Yeah, which I thought was interesting.
And, you know, Leland being in town here over the weekend, he hears the criticism of Al Avila and everything like that, and I understand Leland's perspective on that. But at the same time, you know, people, I think the frustration is real because the expectation, whether fair or not, it was there because, you know, they spent $77 million on Eduardo Rodriguez, because they spent nearly $200 million on Javi Baez and offered north of $250 million to Carlos Correa.
Right.
So I understand where the criticism is, and people are passionate about this team.
I thought it was interesting how Leland kept turning it back over to the players, right? You know, what do we have to do to get this jump started was the first question I asked him. And he's like, we did it. We spent $300 million in the offseason. He's like, these guys just aren't performing the way we anticipated them performing. And, he's a coach, so he comes from that level. So I don't know if he's protecting the coach, if he's protecting the GM, if he's protecting the ownership. And he is a part of the upper management with the Tigers. But I thought it was interesting how he kept putting the onus on the players. Like, listen, we paid the guys because of what they did already in the league. They're just no longer doing it right now. Austin Meadows, nothing from him. And he didn't want to call him out. You could tell
no,
that.
No, but he did.
Also wanted to say, make sure that Hinch is okay. Avila was doing the right things. Like, really interesting to get his perspective.
Stick it. In the last two full seasons of Major League Baseball, which was 2021 and 2019, Austin Meadows has hit 33 and 27 home runs, respectively.
Right.
He has zero this year. And we're not – this isn't mid-April. This isn't the beginning of May. This isn't the end of May. This is mid-June.
Damn near July,
and
right?
And Austin Meadows has zero home runs. So what do you make of that? Is that Al Avila's fault? I mean,
no,
it's not. I'm playing devil's advocate.
It's not Al Avila's fault.
And I know yesterday I came out here and said something has to change. Somebody has to lose their job. I know I said that, and I still believe that, to be honest with you. But is that Al Avila's fault that he goes and gets a player that hits 27 home runs in 2021 and 33 home runs in 2019, which is the last two full seasons of Major League Baseball? And this year, mid-June, he's hit zero? How is that Al Avila's fault?
He traded Isak Paredes, remember? What did I say when he traded him to Tampa Bay?
They're missing Jim.
You think Tampa Bay doesn't know what they're doing? By the way, Isak Paredes has five home runs. Two of them against the Tigers. When they called him up that weekend against the Tigers, and he hit two home runs at Comerica against the Tigers. He was a – Tampa Bay knows what they're doing. They have the best farm team and always one of the best real teams in the Major League
and
Baseball.
And the worst stadium of all time.
Stick, I want you to comment on that. I want
just
to continue this conversation a little bit. But first, we're going to get to a commercial break. I went way over with Jim Leland, so I want to catch up. How do you not? I want to catch up here a little bit and let you know about Lady Jane's Haircuts for Men. Over 100 locations nationwide, many of them locally here in the Metro Detroit area. A precision haircut with a stylist who's always available. Open 7 days a week, 10 a.m. to 8 p.m. All you got to do, walk in, sign in, sit down. Before you know it, you are handsome and clean. Ooh-wee.
Ooh,
Lady Jane's, walk in anytime. It's wicked awesome.
It took exploring 50 different formulas and hosting countless taste tests, but we believe Gypsy Vodka is the smoothest vodka on the market. Don't believe us? Ask the owners.
We're Mike and Adam Kazanowski with High Five Spirits Distillery. We're in close to about 1,200 locations throughout Michigan. We wanted to create a brand that was geared more towards freedom, love, adventure, and at the end of the day, we really wanted to tell a story that inspired other people to take risks, follow their dreams, whatever that might be.
Three NBA championships. Detroit fans were there. 11 Stanley Cups. Detroit fans were there. Four World Series wins. Detroit fans were there.
And that one Lions playoff win in 1991. Yeah, Detroit fans were there.
Woodward Sports, where the fans are.
About the lines earlier today for the NBA Finals tonight. I'm looking at my bookie right now, and it's -4. But are there other lines out there? That's where you want to know. That's where Odds Trader comes in. It's kind of like you go to Kayak, you know, when you're going traveling and you want to find the best price for your flight or your hotel. This is just like that, except it's all for gambling lines. Go to OddsTrader.com right now so you can pick the line that suits you best. Odds Trader. For your best bet.
It's Trader.
Trader!
You know, another aspect of this whole Tiger situation is I know it's not easy to come up and just go ahead and start, you know, owning Major League pitching staffs. But Spencer Torkelson has to go down to Toledo.
I don't think so.
You don't think
so? Why? He's playing on a Triple-A team. Up here!
I'll tell you, to face some AAA pitching, you don't believe.
No.
Let me ask you. Let's explore
confidence.
This a little
it's
bit.
Confidence.
Yes. Let's explore this a little bit, Maz. Do you think betting 175, this kid's not just going to go south? Now, they might. I don't know Spencer Torkelson. Maybe he's a mental wizard and nothing gets the kid down. But in terms of, for lack of a better way to say it, you want to ruin his confidence? I mean, does he need to go down for a couple of weeks and gain confidence?
He was hitting 300 in a bunch of games.
In a 13-game stretch.
Okay. Hey, if Jim Leland says it's not going to hurt him, it's going to only help him, I'm with Jim Leland. I just don't think he has to go down because they're so pathetic. But if he has to go down for his own psyche, by all means, go down.
And that's what we're talking for. About. Okay. Yeah, I'm not right. saying he doesn't have the talent to be on this Tigers team or even a
down.
Championship Tigers team. I'm talking about for his own good and the longevity of it.
Go down and take six guys with you, as far as I can.
But devil's advocate, if he goes down and still struggles, then what?
Well, I mean, I guess the hope is that he won. I mean,
yeah, I get that, but you know, like you're also giving him an opportunity to uber fail instead of just failing at the highest level. But no, I listen. That's what the minor leagues are there for. It's for these pro ballers to get tooled up and to get their legs back under them, to get their timing down, to get their confidence. And if we got to send Torkelson back down, do it, man. He's too young to have these mental issues coming into this season. We know he's a damn good hitter. We've seen it at every step of the way for him in college at Arizona State. We saw him when he was with the Mudhens, when he was with the Whitecaps. The dude can hit. He just, you know, you get in that slump. And baseball is 90% between here, man.
I just can't. I want to see Akil Baddoo come back. And I've heard Raj told us, Rogelio Castillo, who is our Tigers insider here on Woodward Tigers, he told me he was actually down in Double A for a stint as well. Double A. Never mind Triple A. He's back at Triple A. I got to see this kid. I want to see this kid come back because he was really you heard Jim Leyland. He said this kid came out of nowhere. He'd never seen anything like it. 14 home runs like that. The kid had his own jersey within a week of being up here.
Right.
Rule 5 guy for the Minnesota Twins. Never went down last year. Was a spark plug. Was the reason, one of the reasons they won 77 games last year.
No doubt.
And then he just falls off the shelf. I got to see that kid come back. That kid is like the straw that stirred the drink last year. Yeah. I pray that he could come back.
He's 23 years old.
I hope that he could come back. But you've seen that before, though.
People come up, tear up the major leagues for a couple months, and then just...
It wasn't a couple months. It was the whole year.
Chris Shelton had a good season, too, and we never heard from him again.
No,
I mean,
but
Matt
is right on this one. I mean, Akil Baddoo was the whole season. And look, Akil Baddoo is a guy that this Tigers team has been, was counting on this season to improve. I mean, if he took that next step and improved... And look, he's 23 years old. By no means could he just not regain something and get back into the big leagues and have a nice career. But Akil Baddoo has to work. Spencer Torkelson has to work.
Derek Hill.
Riley Green has to work. Daz Cameron has to work. You know, I mean...
So much.
But you only have so many position players to choose from. And basically, if this thing is going to get righted, they all have to work out. There's zero margin for error because there's nobody really with a ton of talent outside of those guys down there, or at least nobody tearing it up that's knocking on the door of a big league career.
No, we're dancing with the girl we brought.
You've got a ton of prospects down there, sure. Like every organization, you got a ton of prospects. But is anybody just tearing it up to the point where they're knocking on the door and you're seeing? I mean, this is June.
Right.
Mid-June here.
No, last year it was Green and Torkelson. Wait till they get up. Wait till they get up. Wait till they get up. This year, you're not hearing any of that buzz out of our minor league teams at all, which, you know, it's kind of scary. But, you know, we have a bunch of young core on this team. And, you know, like Leland said, these guys are supposed to perform. They're paid to perform. Mm-hmm. They're professionals. Be professionals and perform.
I didn't want to bring up the fact that, Jim, I don't want to rain on his parade. You know, 9 shutouts already, and we're in June. They had 9 all last season. What was I going to do, pile on the guy? I mean,
often is he going to repeat himself, too? Like, the team's just not good.
Listen, like, I personally didn't want to brain on the guy's parade. I just don't – I think they're rotten to the core, to be personally frank with you. I just don't – I don't see anything worthwhile on this team, minus a couple of those young rookies.
There's no doubt. You know, another thing, and I asked him, too – think about it for a second. 62 games played.
Yeah.
In 31 of those games, they've scored 2 runs or less.
Yeah, I saw you tweet that out.
50% of their games. In 31% of their games, they scored 1 run or less.
And what's 9 shutouts?
9 shutouts is
10% is out of 61 is 6.
12%.
Yeah.
Something like that.
It's
8%. It's 8%. Gross. It's about 8%. Less than 10%.
It's gross.
It's about 8%. But, I mean, think about that. In 31% of the games, in 20 of 62 games, they've scored 1 run or less.
And they have the least runs scored in the majors.
By a mile.
By 40 plus.
And we're going to set records. I mean, anything we're doing is worth doing right.
We're on our way.
We are on our
way. We're on our way to 2003. Yeah. On our way.
Hey, Jared Goff spoke on a podcast yesterday.
How about
we
that?
Certainly invite the Lions quarterback, Jared Goff, here.
Matter of fact, he owes us one.
He does owe us one. He said he was going to join us last year when he got here. He has not. So we are looking forward to speaking with Jared Goff at some point this season. In the meantime, we will hear what he had to say on the Lions' expectations this year. Spoke about that on a podcast with a former Penn State tight end. So we'll have that audio for you next. Ermanni and Edwards, Woodward Sports Network. But first, a message from Chili Peppers Tanning.
All right. How about that? We're going to be at Chili Peppers Tanning next week. Did you know that? 26 locations.
Thursday, right?
Next Thursday, the 27th, opening up in Harrison Township. We're going to be there. Join the Pepper Club at Chili Peppers Tanning. You get all the best deals, and they will beat all competitors by $5 or more on unlimited tannings. Chili Peppers Tanning, the hottest bulbs, the hottest deals, the darkest tans, your vitamin D headquarters. ChiliPeppersTanning.com for more info.
Hi, my diamonds. It's Crystal with an X. You want to get hot and perfect like me? Here's my super easy routine. Drink at least a gallon of water before you wake up. Attach a weight to everything in your house.
Hello?
Sell your car and just sprint everywhere.
Scream when you exhale.
Don't follow Crystal with an X. Do your own thing at Planet Fitness with tons of equipment and free fitness training in our clean and spacious clubs. Join now for just $10 a month and cancel anytime.
We don't like to brag that we are the toughest sports network in Detroit.
But we do have a guy named Darren McCarty on our side.
LeVue and McCarty, who've had a good knockdown drag up. There they go, right on the whistle. They were talking to one another.
Woodward Sports.
Hey, it's Maz for Big Boy.
Big
Here he is.
Big Boy.
Join us tomorrow. We're going to be there. All three of our shows. In Taylor, that's right, on Telegraph. Come on down and see us. The Strawberry Fest is back. Maybe Joey will be there as Big Boy. If not,
Fish.
Maybe Fish will be the Big Boy tomorrow. We brought back some of the classic breakfast items. I can't wait. The strawberry French toast, the hotcakes, and the waffles. Mm. If you're not feeling breakfast, try the strawberry bacon wrap. How about the chicken nacho bacon wrap? That's nacho cheese.
Oh, so good.
How about the strawberry salad?
Oh, put it in my mouth.
Save some room, too. Save some dessert. Save some room for a slice of strawberry pie. Yours for $1.99 with any purchase of $7.99 or more at a local Big Boy. Be there. Taylor tomorrow.
I can't wait for tomorrow. I get so fat when we do these Big Boy things because I'm there for all three shows.
Wait,
sure the
Big Boy tomorrow?
Yeah.
Taylor.
Oh, Big Boy, Slim Jim, and
the salad.
Hot cake.
I thought you were going to do the salad.
I am going to do the salad.
And the hot
I like that
fudge
oil
brownie.
And Greek. Hot fudge brownie.
I'm having that this time. Yeah.
I mean, that was so good.
You were the slobber in that.
Can somebody give me an address for that?
It's on Telegraph, just south of 94, right there in Taylor.
You know who we're having on tomorrow?
Who?
The great Sean McDonough.
You know what?
The voice of the NHL on ESPN.
Here's a great thing. Speaking of Sean McDonough, I was watching a baseball life.
Who's better
Jim
than
Leland
us, by the
today?
Way.
Nice.
Okay.
And prepping for the interview or just
Yeah. So
random.
I was doing some prep on Jim Leland this morning, and I came across this video. It's a baseball life of Jim Leland that was done in May of 2021. And Bob Costas, interviews and narrates.
Why didn't you tell him?
It was, because we ran out of time.
Oh, okay.
I never want them to say, well, guys, I got to go. I'd rather.
I talked about Hazel Park.
Yeah, I know. But and either way. So, but as part of this baseball life, they were talking about the Atlanta Braves.
Great series.
Pittsburgh Pirates.
Wow.
It was
Francisco Cabrera.
Bases loaded. Two outs.
Sid Bream,
who's a former player of Jim Leland, by the way. And Sid Bream slides home. It was like a movie script.
Yeah.
Right? The throw, the tag, the slide, everything was perfectly done. One inch one way or the other, and he's probably out.
Where were you on the night Sid slid? That's what they asked.
Yeah, I was home. I remember that.
Me too.
Because I was rooting for the Atlanta Braves, coincidentally.
That was their first World Series.
Yeah. But anyway, do you know who had the call of that?
Yeah, Sean McDonough. He called the World Series for CBS.
It was incredible. Yeah. I didn't realize he was around that long.
Yep.
That was like 92.
Remember, he called the Jays, Joe Carter. He called those World Series back-to-backs.
I didn't realize he had that call.
Yes, that was his call.
Really?
He's the best. I love him.
Wow. I didn't realize he's been around that much.
He asked me, man. I'm the announcer guy. I'll tell you who called anything.
That's great. First of all, before we get to some lines.
You know what else he called, right?
Well, probably what?
You know.
Oh, he fumbled the snap.
Fumbled the snap.
And the
trouble
was
the snap.
On the ground.
Jalen Watts Jackson.
Oh,
trouble
with the snap. Oh. Tuck coming.
And it's picked up Tuck by coming. Jalen Watts Jackson.
Out of Patrick St. Mary's.
And he's into the end zone.
Tuck coming.
Oh, my goodness.
What a great game.
Now he just destroyed my voice. I've been talking too much today.
He always tells me, every time I text with him, he says, I know, Maz, I'm your favorite Michigan announcer.
We'll probably wait to get into some Lions talk, actually, because we've got Mark Kestecher coming up at the top of the hour. In about 5 minutes from now, we're going to talk NBA Finals. But in the meantime, I do want to thank Tom Mazawey for this recommendation.
Uh-oh.
Do you know what I did last night when I got home from this job?
Did you watch Hustle?
I watched Hustle.
Oh. Nice.
Did you watch Hustle?
I have not seen it. I keep telling myself I'm going to watch it, and then something pops up, and I haven't sat down and given myself that time yet.
Adam Sandler's a rock star.
It feels like a mini Rocky.
Really?
That's what it felt like to me.
Okay.
Takes place in Philly.
Yeah. It felt like a mini Rocky to me, and it is so well done, and the cameos are great.
Phenomenal.
The NBA, and I'm glad, like, when you make a movie about basketball or the NBA, I don't want to see like some fake jerseys.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, so the NBA supported this movie clearly because it's a LeBron James production.
Yep.
LeBron James.
And it's just so well done.
Surprised he wasn't in it.
Well, it's his production company that produces it.
I know. I'm surprised he wasn't put himself in it.
Yeah. Did you ever watch the show Ballers?
Of course.
Never watched it.
That was another one.
That's The Rock.
It felt authentic, right? Yeah. It didn't feel like it was forced. It was like Entourage for football, essentially. You know how Entourage had all the actors partying with them? Well, he's had all the NFL athletes in there, and they're signing them to contracts and stuff. And to me, that show was fantastic. So I'm really looking forward to watching this.
And Herman Gomez.
Herman is over.
Herman Gomez.
Is that how you pronounce it?
Yeah, he had a good day one time, and I had a buddy who had him on FanDuel or something like that before the betting thing, so you could only do FanDuel.
Bo Cruz.
And they called him the Herman Goat.
The Herman Goat.
But it was really cool. So anyway,
I'll tell you, man, Anthony Edwards was a badass
in that movie.
I hated his guts.
Me
in that
too.
Movie.
He's so good.
He played it well.
Is it better than Blue Chips?
No. Nothing's better than Blue Chips.
Well, all right.
Nothing. Blue Chips is a good movie.
No, it's great.
Great movie?
Great.
Where does it rank on sports movies of all time?
It's in my tops. It's in my tops. In tops. My tops.
In my tops.
In my tops.
Say top 10?
I love it. Yes.
Top 10.
Yes.
I think that could be a top sports movie.
It is college basketball.
Butch McRae.
It's
Shaq. Penny Hardaway.
What's your favorite sports movie of all time?
Oof.
Oh, man, that's hard.
I don't think
Bad News Bears.
Well, look, is Rocky a sports movie?
Oh, no. Hell yeah. Boxing's a sport.
I don't think Rocky's a sports movie, per se. Well, it's the greatest movie of all time.
Then there you
period.
Go.
Period.
Okay, Godfather. So you can't say Rocky. You can't say Rocky.
Bad News Bears and Major League.
Major League.
I love
it. I'm a Field of Dreams guy.
What about Rudy?
I love Rudy.
Rudy's great. Rudy was offside,
like Rudy.
Though. So
Rudy's top
I like
five.
Rudy.
Major League.
I like Rudy.
Yeah. I hate Notre Dame. But Rudy's a great movie.
Basketball, Blue Chips is solid. And, of course, we hit it big. Adam Sandler did it big. I bet you Mark Kestecher will watch that
movie. When I was at Michigan and we played Notre Dame, like the student section, we always wore these shirts that said Rudy sucked.
Yes, of course you did. And he did.
And he did.
My favorite sign when they went to Notre Dame was Rudy was offsides. That's my favorite line of all time.
Don't talk about Sean Astin that way. Right. I love his dad and mom.
So funny. Guys,
Mighty Ducks.
Guys, we'll get into the Lions and Jared Goff's comments on the Lions' expectations this season. He seems very excited about the team. We'll do that in about 15 minutes. But next, we're talking game six of the NBA Finals tonight. He'll have the call on ESPN Radio. Woo-hoo! Mark Kestecher will join us next. But first, a message from Syntron.
Yeah, the summer of Syntron is here. They have already invaded LCA, being the official partner of the Pistons and the Red Wings, plus over there at Comerica Park with the Tigers and with DCFC at Keyworth. So if it's good enough for them, it's good enough for you, and it's now available in select Kroger's. $4 will get you two cans. Make sure you pick it up on a nice hot day like today. Nothing better than a cold Syntron.
When you need apparel, there's only one place to go. Big Frog in Novi. With no setup fees, no artwork fees, no minimum, and a 24-hour turnaround, you can have your whole team outfitted in no time. Embroidery, direct-to-garment, vinyl, and screen printing, Big Frog has it all in all the styles you want. So whether it's a sports team, fundraiser, school event, or corporate needs, Big Frog is your one-stop destination. Visit bigfrog.com/Novi or call 844-4-BIG-FROG.
Woodward Avenue, the first paved road in America.
Woodward Sports,
the first sports network born in Detroit
and made for Detroit.
Welcome back, Woodward Sports Network. Ryan Ermanni, Braylon Edwards out today attending some business in Washington, D.C. He'll be back tomorrow. We've got Sam Day Stick in the house, and of course, Tom Mazawey.
Is Braylon trying to bring back the Bullets nickname?
Well, I hope so.
Me too.
Do you remember when they changed that name, what the joke was?
No.
The Washington Bullets wanted to take violence out of their name, so they'll just now be known as the Bullets. Because remember how violent Washington was back then?
Speaking of names, did you see the George
the
Washington
Colonials
are done.
The Colonials offensive now?
Yeah, they're offensive.
Yes, they are.
I don't even want
to
get into that.
They're rotten to the core.
All right, guys, game six of the NBA Finals tonight. Mark Kestecher will have the call on ESPN Radio, and he joins us now on Woodward Sports Network. How you doing, Mark? Thanks for the time.
Kesty.
Gentlemen, good afternoon. How is everybody?
Doing great, man. Mark, talk to me. I mean, the morning, the day of an opportunity to potentially call an NBA champion. I mean, it could be all over tonight. What's it like for the announcers?
Well, it's personally for me, I do think about, well, if it ends tonight, you know, what am I going to say at the end? And then I say, oh, don't think about that, because that's the worst thing you could do. Just kind of let it happen. I did what any respectable announcer would do. I went to Fenway Park in Boston last night as a Yankee fan.
Yes.
And took my lumps, cat calls, and but enjoyed it. And what a sports day here. There's a Red Sox game going on right now. The U.S. Open, of course, everyone knows is happening down at Brookline, about 7 miles away. We had our production meeting earlier today, so you know, everyone fighting out, trying to carve out their space and what they want to talk about in this game seven. So the good news is, you know, when we're on the West Coast, it happens so fast, you just get to the game here, 9 o'clock, you know, I still have hours to go before we even head over to the arena.
That, it's so funny you say that. I mean, the other night, Golden State is dominating at halftime, and I fell asleep. It was terrible. I hate to admit it, but I wake up at 3:30 in the morning for my TV job. But either way, I record the games and watch them in the morning. But nonetheless, Mark, how would you characterize this series? Because we have seen Boston seem dominant at times. We have seen Golden State seem dominant at times. And I really haven't had a feel for a series, this series from game to game. What do you make of it?
Yeah, I think every time I've been asked how to characterize this series, I just, one word is unpredictable. I'm shocked that we actually had a team win two games in a row, but that's what the Warriors have done. So, you know, when you look at it on paper, you know, it became evident early in the series, you could argue, that the Celtics had the better team. The Warriors had the experience factor, if you will. And then I haven't seen the Celtics live up, you know, to how they play in two games now. I mean, we know turnovers, you know, for both teams is a problem. The Celtics haven't curtailed it. It has played right into the Warriors game. And, you know, on a night Steph Curry didn't have his three-point ball, you know, this great rebounder named Andrew Wiggins came out of nowhere and kind of stole the show for two games. So unpredictable, because I fully expect to get on a plane and go to San Francisco tomorrow morning. I'll be surprised if I'm not. So I'm going to stick with the unpredictable card. I don't know how it's going to get there, but I'm looking forward, hopefully, to a really good game tonight.
Talking to Mark Kestecher, ESPN Radio has the play-by-play call tonight, Game 6. And Tom, you've been saying that all along.
I have. Mark, when this schedule came out, I'm like, 17 days. 17 days they're stretching this sucker out. We'll see you on Father's Day night, and they will have the videos of Michael Jordan crying and hugging Larry O'Brien and all that kind of stuff. There's no way that this thing ain't going all the way. And if I remember correctly, and correct me if I'm wrong, is Adam Silver still under the weather here?
You know, I haven't heard any update if Adam is out of protocols and will be in the building tonight. I know for Mike Breen, it was, what, about three games?
Yeah.
Jeff Van Gundy, I think, only missed one. I mean, everyone's different, you know, whether you can get those two negative tests, but I haven't gotten an update yet. So that was something that was discussed today. If we do, we had to go through our closeout probabilities, you know, having the stage built after the game in Boston, how is a radio crew, we're going to handle that interview-wise, et cetera. And someone did ask, like, who hands out the trophy if Adam Silver's not here? And I wasn't expecting to see Mark Tatum until the second round of the draft on Thursday. But maybe
it'll be Doris Burke.
Yeah, why not? Doris was so great at it. The sender from radio out there.
Absolutely, man. That's awesome.
So, Mark, crossing over to the play-by-play side of it, I mean, I've dabbled in a little bit of color commentary for the first time this year, and I absolutely love that side of broadcasting. But from your perspective and kind of the teams that are playing now, what do you get more excited to call, a big three-point shot or a big dunk? Because back in the day, it was all about the dunks. Now it's all about the three-point shots. What excites you more as a play-by-play guy?
I mean, I love both. And I've probably been, you know, criticized for being a little too amped, if you will. Even I don't think I get crazy on a 2-0 dunk, but, you know, sometimes I'll kind of lose track. And, oh, yeah, it's 12-11. Maybe we can get a little bit. But I think what's interesting, if you look at it from a play-by-play perspective, the three-point shot has become such a great shot to call just because of the nature of how long it takes
right.
to leave the guy's hand and get through the rim. I mean, that's 2 seconds that you get to craft something. And, you know, to me, you can come up with a really good, memorable call if the words come out in the right order and in the right language. So I kind of like the three-pointer. If I was given the choice, I think that's the better one to call, at least for me.
Hey, Mark, yesterday we had Isaiah Thomas on, former Piston, 2-time champion, one of the great point guards in NBA history. He was raving about Steph Curry. Where would you put Steph Curry in the history of this game? I point guards for a guy like me, you know, I think of Isaiah Thomas and Magic Johnson. I mean, those are the guys of my youth, so I'll immediately point to them. Where does Steph Curry fit into all of this?
Yeah, he's an interesting case. I mean, as a player as a whole, you know, he's going to be, I think, remembered among the very greats, especially for transforming the game, transforming it geometrically so defenses are stretched, and also how, you know, game plans are made now, where we're seeing, you know, 40, 50 3-point attempts per night. You know, that's crazy talk like 5-10 years ago, and not anymore. It always gets dangerous, you know, because of how many great players there have been. And even if you try to pin someone down to, you know, who are your best 15, you could have to the death arguments over it. But I think at the core also of what you're saying, you know, when we're looking at point guards, is, you know, is he a true point guard? And is anybody a true point guard anymore? I mean, look at Marcus Smart in this series. You know, guys who might be more traditionally off ball or who have, you know, different elements to their game. In Marcus's case, you know, a defensive element, but we're going to let you, you know, bring the ball up. And in fact, 5 guys can bring the ball up on many of these teams now, from right. small center right down to point guard. So, you know, in the history of point guards, I don't know if it's fair. I mean, he's going to be listed as such. But just on the whole, if he gets this championship tonight or on Sunday night and gets – I mean, the finals MVP doesn't mean that much to me. But when you look at it historically and you got guys who win MVPs, multiple MVPs as he has, a finals MVP would be 4 championships, all the all-star games. He's going to be right up there with some of the very best who've ever played the game.
Mark Kestecher joins us. Kesty, of course, the play-by-play voice of ESPN Radio will be on the call tonight. Game 6 of the NBA Finals, Celtics, and, of course, the Warriors from the Boston Garden. Well, the new Boston Garden, that is. Remember the old Boston Garden, Mark? How many games did you get to do in that old barn?
I never worked in there. I walked by it. I'm from upstate New York, which is about 3 hours west of here. And we were just talking last night. We took the T to Fenway from TD Garden, or North Station, as it's known. And we were talking last night. I was with a Bostonian, and I said, so where exactly was the Garden? And, you know, he basically showed me not only where it was, but how close it was to the new Garden. And when they took it apart, he said it was literally 3 or 4 feet separated the retaining walls of both. I don't know how they got that building down, but that's a long way to say no. I never called a game in that building.
Hey, I'm a Jersey guy myself from Hoboken, New Jersey. I remember did a trip to the old Boston Garden. We did a Celtics Hornets game. It was the last game of the season. Then during the day and at night, we saw a Bruins and Canadians playoff game. So we did a double game there. But by the way, the Red Sox losing to the Oakland A's today. So that's good news for our Yankees.
And as an upstate New Yorker, I am programmed to hate every single Boston team.
Oh, yeah. Of course. I explained to my guys, there's no hate like the Red Sox hate that I had.
Said it yesterday.
Yeah, I can't help it.
I love the city. I kind of love its people. I do love its sports stadium. I appreciate Fenway Park, you know, for what it's worth. But I know I raised my daughter right. We went into a sporting goods store once where I live in Connecticut, which is, you know, you're right on the Mason-Dixon line of Yankees Red Sox. And she came out crying. She's like 3 or 4 years old. And I'm like, what happened? And she said, I rubbed against a big poppy uniform. And I said,
that's so great.
It's gross.
Mark, do you rock a Yankees hat when you walk into Fenway, or are you a little more understated?
You know, I thought about it. I did not, although Kevin Winter, who's our studio host, is from Foxborough, so he is dyed in the wool in New England. And I have 2 Yankee T-shirts with me and a Yankee hat, and I try to carry as little clothes as I can on these trips. And I go about 20-minute walk into the city and back to, you know, print some stuff for the games. And he always marvels that I haven't been shanked or mugged or disappeared. I did rock the Yankee hat last night.
That is so great.
How's our guy Al Rosenberg? We love him, you know.
Oh, the great Al Rosenberg, making me sound good. I don't like when we get to this 1-1-1 portion of the 2-2-1-1-1 format, because we don't get to golf like we do in the early rounds.
And yeah,
if I did bet him, he'd take my money. But he's the best.
Hey, Mark, final thing for you. In the Warriors' 3 wins, they have been lower scoring games, all of them. In the Celtics' 2 wins, higher scoring games.
Wow.
Both of them. What happens tonight? What do we see tonight?
I think Jason Tatum, we've been waiting for the Jason Tatum game. And 2 series ago, when they were down 3-2 to Milwaukee, he put up 46 points. I don't know if he's going to score 46 tonight, but he's just got to relax. And, you know, Ime Udoka has been in his ear for a week now to just calm down. You know, you don't have to drive into 2 players, throw your hands in the air, and Golden State's going the other way with a 5-on-4 advantage. I think he told us yesterday in the meetings, he came into our ESPN radio meetings yesterday, that he's just clearing the mental part of it. He's not listening to the outside noise. I got a sense of a guy who realizes they're up against it and they're going to look to him. It doesn't have to be all him, but I think a Jason Tatum game, which naturally is going to raise their scoring. They can't turn it over 16 times. I mean, that's just bottom line. If they're going to give Golden State points, championship's going to end tonight with the Warriors.
He'll have the call. Game 6 of the NBA Finals tonight on ESPN Radio. Give him a listen. One of our favorites, an absolute gem on the mic, Mark Kestecher. Thank you so much, sir. Have a great call tonight.
I appreciate it. Thanks for having me on, guys.
Thanks, Kesty. See you Sunday.
See you Sunday. Mass is guaranteeing it. Look, Mark Kestecher is one of the best in this business.
He is.
Period. I would put him up against just about anybody.
He used to be like the studio guy, handing it off to all these guys. Yeah. Then they give him a play-by-play, and he hasn't looked back.
We are, Mass and I, I don't want to speak for you. We love the announcers. The announcers make the game for us. I don't care if it's a low-level regular season game or if it's high-stakes championship, you know, the announcers can make or break a game.
They're the
sure.
icing on the cake, right? Like, the game's the cake. But when you have the announcers that are giving you that energy and giving you, you know, I'm a big Tony Romo fan. Like, when he first came on, giving you that insight, calling out the plays, like, that's what I love as a fan. And like he said, he gets a little too excited. Not for me listening. I love when the people I'm watching with are excited. So I feel that through the TV.
But, you know, when you think of announcers, so many people go right to those guys like, you know, Joe Buck or Al Michaels or Jim Nance. Or who's like, give me Mark Kestecher. Give me Kevin Kugler.
Dan Shulman.
Give me, you know, any of those guys.
Yep.
You know, any day of the week.
Give me a Neil Rule.
Yeah,
of course. I love his calls,
there
man.
There you go.
Gus Johnson.
Yeah, but I mean, you think of him, but I'm just talking about these guys.
The second guys. Well, my favorite is Kevin Burkhart. Wait, Kevin, you guys are going to be in love with him this year.
But that's
on Fox.
That's a great example. Yeah. You know, Burkhart, Kestecher, Kugler. I mean, some of these guys are really freaking good at what they do and way underappreciated. Guys, we're going to get into some Lions talk next. You'll hear from Jared Goff, Ermanni and Edwards, bottom line. But first, a message from Guardian Alarm. They are your local security experts, have been for over 90 freaking years. Whether it's your home or your business, Guardian Alarm will keep you safe, give you peace of mind. 24/7 local monitoring. You can do everything remotely as well. Lock, unlock your doors, whatever the case may be. They are there for you. All you have to do is call this number above my head right now. 1-800-STAY-OUT. That number again, 1-800-STAY-OUT. Guardian Alarm is there for you, even when you're not.
Stay-out.
How about that?
That's Canadian.
I just coined that phrase.
He's going deep right side. Oh, that is Edwards out there. He goes up in the air at the goal line.
Hey, it's Brandon Edwards here, wanting to welcome the Sports Marketing Agency to Woodward Sports Network, to the family. Glad to have you guys. For the last decade, the Sports Marketing Agency has literally leveraged athletes around issues such as mental health and substance abuse.
Glad that we can finally start trying to get the stigma off of mental health that's been there for all these years.
New to the game or a seasoned bettor? OddsTrader.com has everything you need to make the right bet ahead of kickoff. Begin your handicapping journey with OddsTrader. Improve your edge by finding the best price on every game from sportsbooks in your backyard. Take advantage of the numerous sign-up bonus offers to pad your bankroll. Dive into key game statistics, player performance, and even account for the projected game day weather. Best of all, you can use the OddsTrader bet tracker to keep a log of your action. Welcome to OddsTrader, and best of luck.
Make sure you're listening to Woodward Sports all day long. Start your morning with the Morning Woodward Show.
Spend middays with Big D Energy.
Watch and listen your drive home with the bottom line.
And don't forget about Woodward Bets daily.
All live. All right here on the Woodward Sports Network.
Thanks for tuning in. If you are watching on YouTube, go ahead and hit that like button for us. Let's get to over 100 likes. Let's do that by the end of the segment. How about that, Stick?
Yeah, we can get over
that.
We can hit
the
C note.
Could. Also, subscribe to Woodward Sports on YouTube. Having a lot of fun here with my guy, Stick. It is, again, this name thing. It's so hard for me not to say two names.
You could say it.
I'm going to say it.
Well, you say Braylon.
Say Braylon Edwards.
You say Maz.
Say Ryan Ermanni, Braylon Edwards, Tom Mazawey.
Yeah, you're right. You do.
He calls you by the proper. Initially,
and then you get into it.
I got it.
You see what I'm saying?
You know what I told Jim Leland when I introduced who he was going to have on? I said Sam Stick Day.
You said that to him?
Yeah.
He knows my name?
Well, I said Sam Stick Day.
Now he does.
Yeah. I don't want to say Stick because I could hear him say, I'm going, what the hell, Stick? What's a stick?
Oh, good stuff.
I love Jim Leland so much, man.
He's the greatest.
So much.
I never saw you so excited.
I don't get starstruck. Like, I don't, like, listen, you know, through my radio.
You were testing the phones. You were doing everything.
My radio
I never
career,
saw that.
I've interviewed Jay-Z. I've interviewed, like, Lil Wayne. I've interviewed Kelly Clarkson.
Lil Wayne? Nothing compared to Jim Leland.
Lil Wayne?
I don't get excited for artists. I get excited for, like, coaches and athletes that I respect. I've always been more excited to talk to an athlete than an artist. And it's because I tried to be an athlete and I could never be it. And I have so much respect for the people.
You're a good softball player.
I'm a good beer league softball player. That's awesome. No, I wanted to be at the top level. And it's just, it's hard, man. And I have so much respect for any guy that climbs that mountain and gets to that level, because it's hard, you know. Like, we're talking to Braylon Edwards. What he did, not too many people ever did in their life. Number three overall pick, you know.
Right.
Kick ass at Michigan. Went to the pros, had a, you know, 1,000-yard season. It's hard to be a professional athlete. So I have a ton of respect for anybody that suits up and steps between the lines.
It's easy.
Yeah.
Guys, I wanted to talk about this because Jared Goff was on a podcast just yesterday. He was on with Adam Brenneman, who is a former All-American tight end from Penn State. I never heard of him before, but he's got a podcast. Everybody's got a podcast. Yeah.
He's got a decent following.
Absolutely. Yeah. He does have a really nice following. But Jared Goff sat down with him for an hour. And Jason Kabinda.
How about that?
And they talked about a number of different things. Really good listen, actually. I listened to about 30 minutes
of it. I retweeted it. If guys want to check out my Twitter, you'll find it.
Very good. And here's what he had to say. Here's just a snippet of some of the things he had to say, Lions expectations and the like.
It's fun to play for a fan base like this and to play in a place that is so passionate. You know, like last year, we're 2 wins against the Packers in the last game of the season. The place is sold out.
Yeah.
And we win, and it's loud in the fourth quarter.
And when we get to winning this year, oh my goodness, the city's turning up. I promise.
That's right.
The city's going up. I mean up, like dying for a winner up. Yeah. I promise.
Yeah. That's like, again, like I spoke about, like the opportunity we have in front of us this year is so special and doesn't come around. And I've had experiences of like Cal 1-11, Rams first year, bad. Mm-hmm. You know, that flip around is nothing like it.
Yeah.
And doing it in a place like this with the fan base we have and with the people who are so passionate in this city that's been wanting it for so long. And I know it's been said a million times, but actually doing it is the opportunity of a lifetime that, you know, hopefully we can take advantage of.
Yeah, it'll be unreal.
And I think that's what you're looking for with, you know, Jared Goff, right? I mean, I do like and stick, say what you just said off air on it right now, because I think you really hit the nail on the head. The fact that they understand a little bit about this city and where we were and where we are and where we want to be.
Yeah, and you got to think about it for a guy like Jared Goff, who was playing in L.A., and L.A. is infamous for not really caring about their sports teams outside the Lakers and particularly USC football, you know. So he played for the Rams, took him to the Super Bowl. But he's talking about, listen, last game of the season, we're playing the Packers, and they're going nuts, and we're 3-13. Like, what the hell is going on here? And then Kabinda chimes in like, yeah, this city's going to go nuts if we provide a winner. And it's awesome that the locker room's having that conversation, that these guys are so self-aware to know that if they deliver this city a winner, there will be statues built for everybody around this whole city. And a Lions celebration almost scares me to what the hell it's going to be on Woodward if anything ever happens. Even if we get a playoff game, a home playoff win, when those 65,000 fans lead Ford Field, it is going to be something like we've never seen in sports history here in Detroit.
If you don't think for a second that Dan Campbell doesn't have something to do with that, you'd be fooling yourself. That's a guy that's got that locker room together, and he knows what this city is wanting.
Yeah, and the thing I love about Kabinda speaking up about it, if you remember last year, Dan Campbell talking about Kabinda, if he had to pick one guy to get in a street fight and have his back, he picked Kabinda. He's like, that's my guy. That's the mentality that he has. Those are the type of guys that they're bringing in. I was reading an article earlier today about Brad Holmes and Dan Campbell and how they keep using the term cut from the same cloth when referring to each other. And mind you, they were hired separately. So the fact that these two have melded so well together, I was worried we hired a head coach before a GM.
Right.
I thought that was going to cause problems, but these guys are in lockstep. And the article I was reading about how Antoine Randall really wanted Jameson Williams.
We're going to have that next.
Yeah.
We do have that audio. We'll play that for you after the break. But, you know, I think with Jared Goff, too, you know, one of the I hope he proves all of us wrong.
Me too.
I really do. I want him to
give
everybody a nice crap burger to eat.
Me too.
Like
I'd eat one.
You know, seriously. I mean,
you just say you'd eat one?
I'd eat one.
Just dookie on everybody's just, you know, seriously. I mean, this guy's taken so much heat, and I don't think he's as bad as we make him out to be.
Hell no.
And I think he's very, very serviceable. And I think he might be even an above-average quarterback, or at least we hope. I've talked myself into that, at least. Now, is he going to be the quarterback when this team competes for a Super Bowl in 3 years? I don't know. But I think for right now, he's exactly what they need.
He's competing our guy. For a Super Bowl?
I think we might compete for a Super Bowl next year.
Okay, good.
I did say 10 wins this year, so if you're in the playoffs, you are competing for a Super Bowl.
If you're in the fight, you got a chance. That's all I've ever asked for. Right.
You mentioned Antoine Randall L. You will hear from him right out of the break. We're going to play that for you. Lions wide receiver coach Antoine Randall L. Excited. How excited was he? We'll have that for you next, but first a message from Gypsy Vodka.
Yeah, Randall L. may be excited, but not as excited as I am to get out on a golf course with a can of Mulligan in my hand. It's new from Gypsy Vodka. They mix the lemonade, they mix the iced tea, and they mix the vodka together, and you get this delicious, refreshing drink to enjoy, whether you're golfing or not. Hell, take it to the putt-putt course. I don't care. It's Mulligan. It's delicious. Iced tea, lemonade, vodka, and support your Michigan distillers with Gypsy Vodka and the Mulligan.
Hi, I'm Kay Cunningham. I'm proud to partner with Hall Financial, the mortgage company known for five-star service. Don't just take my word for it. Check out their 5,000 five-star reviews for yourself. Go to callhallfirst.com and get started with your five-star experience today.
You don't have to go to the beach, man. You don't have to get your butt cracked full of sand. You just need a little chili peppers, man, to get that glowing beach chili peppers tan.
With 26 locations in the Metro Detroit area and more coming, Chili Peppers Tanning is where you'll find the cleanest salons in the D. Join the Pepper Club for the best deals on unlimited tanning. Head to ChiliPeppersTanning.com.
You just need a little Chili Peppers, man.
Make sure you download the Woodward Sports app in the App Store and the Google Play Store today. Take Woodward Sports with you wherever you go and listen live on your phone or mobile device.
Bedrock and Rocket Mortgage turned an old parking lot into a massive outdoor playground right next to Campus Martius. There's roller skating, basketball courts, a mini golf course, food trucks, live music performances, and art installations. It's such a fun place to visit whether you're out on a date, with the family, or hanging out before a Tigers game.
With the family.
With the family.
Family.
And they've even got Wi-Fi so you can take your computer and work in the heart of the city. You only have to pay for roller skating and food, but everything else is free. For more information and midway hours, go to deckedoutdetroit.com.
How realistic did you think the chance were that you were going to get in?
I wasn't sure. It was not realistic, to be honest with you. Yeah, I wasn't sure. I wasn't sure at all. But I was really excited when I got him.
You saw the video?
Yeah,
we
saw you crash the roof there. Oh, they showed that? I don't know, Eamon. I don't know. I didn't know about the video. Yeah, well, you saw I was excited. Well, there you go. I was excited.
How great is that? Seriously, awesome. How great is that? You know?
And you've seen it 2 years in a row in the war room, right? You saw it last year with Panay Sewell when they got him, Dan Campbell. I mean, they damn near picked up Sheila Hamp and was, you know, shaking her around. And then this year, Antoine Randall L., it's like, man, what other weapon can you give your wide receiver coach than arguably the number one wide receiver to come out in the draft?
Although he's hurt.
Huh?
Although he's hurt.
He will be fine.
For now. He's hurt. You know. He's not injured. Big difference.
One of the storylines with Jameson Williams is I will be curious to see what they do with him, because they're going to start him in training camp on the PUP list, the physically unable to perform list. If he goes into the season after training camp on that list, it's an automatic 6 weeks.
Yeah. They ride that out.
Do you think that he does the 6 weeks? Or 100%. Do you think that maybe you just put him on the active roster and just go week by week?
No, he's done for that.
You err on the side of caution with this. This is the future of the franchise. This is something you gave up multiple picks to go get. And it's somebody that, you know, if you go on our YouTube page, we have the sports doctors. They broke down his injury. Yeah. And they did a really great job. I think the thing's got like 15,000 views on it right now. But But they go over how he can come back from this, but just give it time. Yeah. And I'm in no rush to bring him back. We got DJ Chark. Let's see what Chark can do, because I feel like when he comes back, he's kind of going to take that Chark position.
Yeah, I mean, you certainly do not have the desperation that you did a year ago at that position.
Right.
We all forget about Josh Reynolds, right? I mean, you could go Chark, Reynolds, and Amon-Ra, and there's a pretty darn good three wide receiver set.
Right.
Now, I don't know if Cephas will be around or not.
I think he will.
Do you think he'll be healed and ready to go? I don't know. I guess I should pay attention a little bit more to that. Khalif Raymond is nothing to sneeze home at, you know, or whatever the moniker is there. But nonetheless, I think this football team is in prime position. Now, my guy Prague, and I hope I'm saying your name right. If I'm not, I apologize. Prague Patel over there on the YouTube chat says he is with me on most of my takes except the Lions win total take. And I'm fine with that.
Fair.
I fully believe, if healthy, this team can win 6 games at home, 6-3 at home, 4-4 on the road. I just don't think that's out of the realm of possibilities of things that happen. I mean, just look at the road games alone. Jets, Giants.
Right.
So I think you can get both of those. I think you can beat the Bears in Chicago. That's 3 right there. Give me 1 more of 5.
I think it helps that we have, like, the 3rd easiest schedule in the league.
Fourth.
Okay. On paper. Last year we were top 5 toughest.
They have the 5th easiest schedule. All 4 teams in the NFC East have an easier schedule.
Well, thank God we got the NFC East right on the docket today. But, no, it says here Cephas is in competition in practice. He's making plays. So he ready to rock,
great
man. And I'm a big Quintez Cephas fan.
I agree. That wide receiver room is incredibly talented.
In better shape than it has been.
Absolutely. Guys, and then there's this about Aidan Hutchinson, right? Lions defensive line coach Todd Wash had this to say.
Well, he's got some questions in this as well. So
Listen to this.
When you see a defensive prospect like that, is there an it factor when it comes to a guy that high on a draft board that does that well in college?
We knew he was going to be a good pass rusher. Like I said, I think we got a better player than I thought we were going to get, to be honest with you. And once he's gotten out here, he's everything as advertised. So we cannot be happier with how he fell to us at number 2. We're excited. Yep.
When that fit in camp, and a guy like that comes in and surprises you like that, is there something that you can remember in your career where somebody jumps out that you can compare him to?
Yannick Ngakoue, we took him later in the draft, but he led college in sacks his senior year. And when he came in, he just had it. As a pass rusher, and Hutch has it as a pass rusher, and he still has enough play strength to play a lot of different spots up front, and he's intelligent where he can play a lot of different fronts. So, you know, when it comes to that, yeah, he has it as a pass rusher.
When you say that you're getting a better player than you thought you would get, and he's the number 2 player, that's going to raise a lot of eyebrows. Well, what is it? I mean, I know you mentioned a few things, but I mean, that's saying a lot about a young player. Expectations that you're kind of putting on us.
Yeah, I think, you know, at this level, there's expectations for somebody drafted that high. But like I said, he has probably higher expectations than we do. You know, so he comes in and works every day. Unbelievable, intelligent young man. I mean, it's amazing how well he's picked stuff up and understands what we're asking him to do and how to do it. So, like I said, he's more athletic than I thought he was. That just tells you how bad of an evaluator I am.
That's good stuff there. And that was Todd Wash, Lions defensive line coach. And look, he said it twice in that 1 minute and 30-second media session. It was that he is a better athlete than we saw on tape. And the tape tells you a lot. Tape usually tells you the whole story, but not everything. And I think that's great news, right? Isn't that what you want to hear from your position coach?
I'll tell you, man, it's going to be something watching – the Jags' number 1 pick, and his name.
Did they move him to another position? Did they move him to outside linebacker as a primary position?
I don't know, but it's going to be something to watch.
The Jags are going to Jaguar. We know that.
What he
they're
going
to mess something up.
What he does compared to what Aidan Hutchinson does is going to be really something to key on going forward, because we might have been dealt an ace finally.
Yeah, by them taking Trayvon Walker? Yeah. Hell yeah. And that's honestly, I was just going
to
mention
this. Or he might turn out to be Lawrence Taylor. So who knows?
Who knows? Who knows? Yeah. But has there ever been less, like, hype about the number two overall pick here in Detroit? Like, when we got Ndamukong Suh, I remember getting him with the number two. Like, that was all the talk for months, right? Jameson Williams seems to be the more lightning rod of our first round draft picks. I haven't heard much about Aidan Hutchinson, which is good because sometimes no news is good news. That means he's doing what he's supposed to do. But it's nice to see these coaches coming out and talking about him in this light. But I think it's very strange. We had the number two overall pick in the NFL draft, and we've spent more time talking about Jameson Williams than anybody else.
Well, think about it. It wasn't exciting at draft night either. Remember?
It was, here it is.
It was like, who the hell was going to – who are we going to pick? Who are they going to pick? It was nobody that was outstanding. No one wanted the one or two pick. No one wanted it.
I knew I saw this on Twitter somewhere. Andrew Buller Russ put Jacksonville Jaguars view Trayvon Walker as a force as outside linebacker.
Okay.
That's what they believe he is. So they took a defensive lineman first overall. They're going to take him off the defensive line?
I guess, and the fact that they didn't try to protect their franchise quarterback that they took last year was mind-blowing, too. Jags are a strange team to me. I don't understand what the hell's going on down there. Khan is just doing what Khan does.
My goodness. Either way.
And how about, you know, we haven't heard from Zach Pascal yet. I mean, has he healed up our number three pick? Has he healed up yet?
I know nothing
about Pascal. Supposedly
he
was injured. And,
our other injured guy that we've picked?
That we drafted injured,
Is he going to heal up?
I know nothing about Pascal.
Okay. I didn't know anything about him draft night. If you go back and watch our day two draft coverage from here in the studio, Scott Bischoff was really high on him. And then I did some research, and I got really high on this kid. I mean, coming out of Kentucky, playing against SEC opponents every week, and he was still able to put up monster numbers when he was really the only guy on that Kentucky defense you had to worry about. So, like, I like those players that transcend small schools over big schools. And if you're going up against SEC guards and tackles for your entire college career, you're going to be okay.
Scott also cost me $100 on Thibodeau.
Well, that was the Lions. That was on the Lions. That wasn't Scott. The Lions did a great job with their smoke screens
this year. I'm joking.
A great job.
Scott's great.
No, his agent.
Still pissed about it.
Thibodeau's agent texted Scott and said, yeah, we're coming to the Lions.
He had the number three pick right to the Texans.
Yeah.
There you go.
But when an agent texts you, it's like, yeah, we got the call. You take it serious. But the Lions, I love it. They smoke screened them.
Guys, we're going to take a break. When we come back, game six of the NBA Finals tonight. Who you got? What number you got? Also, some baseball, hockey.
Ooh, yeah.
Lots going on in the betting world. We're going to talk to Scottie G. Woodward Bets. We'll do it next. Ermanni and Edwards. Speaking of betting, here's a message from MyBookie.
Oh, that's me.
That's me.
MyBookie coming up. That's right. Scottie G is going to tell you the 4-1-1 coming up on tonight's NBA game number six. It's the Warriors in Boston against the Celtics. Think the spread's 4 right now. Celtics favored. They need to win to keep this game, keep this series going. If you're going to bet, go to mybookie.ag. Use the promo code Woodward. They'll double your first deposit all the way up to $1,000. That's free money in your pocket. Bet anytime, anything, anytime, anywhere with MyBookie. If you have a gambling problem, please use the Michigan Problem Gambling Hotline, 1-800-270-7117.
Hi, my diamonds. It's Crystal with an X. You want to get hot and perfect like me? Here's my super easy routine. Drink at least a gallon of water before you wake up. Attach a weight to everything in your house.
Hello?
Sell your car and just sprint everywhere.
Scream when you exhale.
Don't follow Crystal with an X. Do your own thing at Planet Fitness with tons of equipment and free fitness training in our clean and spacious clubs. Join now for just $10 a month and cancel anytime.
Make sure you're listening to Woodward Sports all day long. Start your morning with the Morning Woodward Show.
Spend middays with Big D Energy.
Watch and listen your drive home with the Bottom Line.
And don't forget about Woodward Bets daily.
All live, all right here on the Woodward Sports Network.
Welcome back, Woodward Sports Network. Ryan Ermanni, Sam Stick Day.
There it is.
Tom Mazawey as well. We got Sam Flannel Fletch in the house as well. Take you to the top of the hour at 4:30 today. It'll be Woodward Bets on the old Woodward Sports Network. And it is a pleasure to welcome in the great Scottie G, part of the Woodward Bets crew. Scottie G, how you doing, my friend?
Oh, Scottie.
Hey, I am doing great. I mean, you just got to stay in the cool weather, that, or, you know, cool basement. But, yeah, we've been on fire over there at Woodward Betts. You guys got to make sure you're checking us out, man. We've been absolutely kicking butt. We've been talking about the weather, all the heat and cross baseball. Man, 24 runs scored in Chicago. I mean, hey, we called that one. That was an easy one. But we got all kinds of fun stuff to talk about here today. So, hey, glad to be with you guys here. I got to see Maz the other night at the bowling alley. So that was a treat, but nice glad job, to be here Scotty. With you guys.
Scotty had the sub for me with my bad back.
Oh, yeah.
Yep,
how do you do?
You're a good bowler.
What do you want?
Better than
you're both good bowlers.
Yeah, he's better than me.
He's better than you?
He likes it. Maz, you like it when Scotty G subs for you. Absolutely. And by the way, Scotty G walked in today, and you know Maz giving me the rundown and what we're going to do today. He's like, hey, Scotty G's on fire. He's on the show today.
Yeah. We have been, man. I'll tell you. I mean, last night, normally I give out a best bet for the network over there about 6:30, 6 o'clock, we tweeted out. I couldn't decide which of the three, so I just gave all three, and boom, all three hit. So
nice.
It was good. Like we said, we've been, you know, sticking our foot right up the bookie's ass here in the last week or so. So, hey, you
there
guys
got to
make sure you're checking
it
out.
All right, let's do it again. Are we going to Father's Day with this NBA Finals, or is it over tonight, Scotty?
I think we're going to Father's Day. I mean, we kind of called that at the beginning. I mean, they stretched it out for a reason. I mean, you just look at kind of what happened. If I had to do Curry was going 0-9 before that last game started, there's pretty much no way you would have bet on Golden State. But, yeah, I mean, Golden State's just been causing all kinds of problems. You know, what they've been doing is they, you know, Boston was trying to basically focus on Curry on defense. Now they're basically switching. As soon as it comes down, Curry switches off the primary guy. So it's kind of messed them up. They weren't, you know, very good looks. Boston literally missed their first 12 three-point shots. They missed 10 free throws at that last game. And plus, right now, they're on pace to literally have the most points scored on them off of turnovers in any finals game. At this point, they have the second most of all time points given up off turnovers. So they just got to tone it down a little bit, tighten up the ship a little bit, and I think Boston gets it done tonight at home. I mean, the spread went from 4. It's already down to 3.5 in some spots. And literally, the last 26 NBA games have the outright winner has covered the spread. So don't worry about the points. Pick the side you want and just roll with it here. But I'm all over the Celtics here tonight. I just don't see any reason why it doesn't go back to Golden State.
Talking to Scotty G, part of the Woodward Betts team, 4:30 here on Woodward Sports Network. Scotty, in the three Warriors wins, the games have all been under. In the two Celtics wins, the games have both gone over. Is there a correlation there that you see that, I mean, kind of 5 for 5, depending upon which team you like, the total seems to be, you know, like I said, if the Warriors win, it's under. If the Celtics win, it's over. Is that an angle that somebody should look at tonight as well?
Yeah, I mean, I don't mind that, you know, angle either. I mean, but really what's happening there is, you know, Golden State likes to get out and run a little bit more in Boston. And I think when, you know, Boston's ahead, Golden State plays at a quicker pace. And I think they're the one controlling the pace of the game most of the time. So, but I do think tonight is going to be a higher scoring game. I do have a little bit of lean on the over tonight because, I mean, like I said, Boston shot poorly. And I think they're coming back home. You know, what was that? You know, maybe they'll raise the rim up another 6 inches
there it is.
On Golden State's side here before the game starts as they got caught doing that last time. But that was kind of funny.
It was.
But, yeah, I do expect that we're going to see a higher scoring game, and I think the Celtics are going to pull it out.
All right, Scotty, give me some baseball today. We got a couple of games I got on the radar. Rays and Yankees. Last night's game was epic. And then we got the Tigers and the Rangers. Do you keep going against the Tigers? Do you keep betting the under on the Tigers, or are the Rangers going to go over on their own?
Yeah, I've been betting the under on the Tigers for a while. I mean, they're terrible. I mean, like you guys were mentioning yesterday, they're literally 40 runs lower than the second worst team in the league. They only have 5 homers against left-handed pitching in the whole season. I mean, it's just god-awful. So like I said, hey, they suck. Let's just make money off them. So, yeah, I do like the unders. But tonight I'm rolling with these Rangers on the money line, minus a run and a half. They actually have been on a pretty good streak. Now, they're not always the favorite, but if they're dog, they obviously get a run and a half. But I was looking here. I mean, Texas literally has covered the last 30 out of their last 46 games on the run line. So I don't expect that to change at all. I think Texas wins by a couple runs. And I could see like a 6-1, 6-0, something along those lines. And two, I was looking at exit velocity. I know that's a pretty big thing everybody likes to talk about. Maz, your Yankees are number one in all of MLB, yeah, and our Tigers dead last. So
unbelievable.
It's just two night and day there. But Yankees, I mean, I was thinking about it. Aaron Judge has more homers than the guy with the most RBIs on the Tigers.
That's a fact. And that's Miguel Cabrera.
So bad.
By the way, 25 versus 21 RBIs there. How about the hockey? Last night had to go to overtime. It looked like it was going to be a big-time over game. It was 3-3 before you knew it. Wound up 4-3 on the final. Avalanche get the win. Who do you like on? Of course, now they're going to spread this one out. Saturday night, game number two, Avs and Lightning. Do you like the Lightning to come back? And do you like the over in that one?
You know what? I actually jumped on Tampa the first game. I thought, you know, Colorado sitting for 8 days.
Me too.
Might bite him in the ass a little. Yeah. We've seen it many times. You know, a team comes out flat after sitting for a while. But I think Colorado got lucky with them two kind of goals right there at the beginning. They were just poor goals given up by Vasilevskiy. I think that had a lot to do with that whole game. I really like the under in this one. Now it's at 6. That means you need 7 goals to lose. I think it's going to be under. Vasilevskiy, I mean, like I said, he gave up 2 cheap ones there at the beginning. But I've also been attacking his save totals. Usually he's about 32, 33. Last night he ended up just barely getting it over for us, but at 34. But he's hot with those two. So look at the Vasilevskiy's over in the save total. Another thing, too, going back to the game, one other prop real quick I forgot about. Man, Wiggins' rebound prop started at 5.5 two games ago, 6.5 last game. It's up to 7.5, and he's been getting double-digit rebounds. I even like his alternate rebounds over 10 tonight. So just something to keep in mind as well.
Those unders in hockey are tricky, man, because I've seen more empty net goals this year than I have ever seen in my life. I mean, if you think about it too, Scottie, I mean, you're looking at a 3-2 game. An empty netter gets you at least the push. And then a 3-3 game, you automatically win. I mean, if you had the over 6 last night, it's 3-3 with, you know, 15 minutes to go in the third period. You're already won.
You're celebrating.
You're like going to, you don't even care to watch overtime.
The risk of betting the unders in hockey. But I mean, if you got the over and that empty net sitting down there for you and you see that puck floating down the ice, you're just like, come on, you know, get in there for the winner. You know, that's happened many times, you know, over my days. But I mean, I just think in these Stanley Cup games, you're just going to see them be a little bit tighter. I think Tampa is going to try to tighten it up a little bit more. They know they can't go down 2-0. I mean, in our road games, you know, they always say series don't start until, you know, road team wins. But we'll see what happens. I think I actually like Colorado to win straight on the money line. But it's like 150. It's just a little too high, too much juice for me to pay. I'm not sure I want to bet on them, you know, minus a goal and a half. But I do like the under so far in this one.
Hey, Scotty, last thing from me. Are you an NFL futures guy? Do you look at a win total? Do you play a game early? I mean, with the lines out in the NFL now, I mean, hell, even Michigan State has a line out where Michigan's a 9-point favorite. I mean, do you look at things that far in advance? And would you, you know, for our state, there's a lot of new bettors in our state right now. Is that something? Is that an area that you would tell people to look at as far as the futures market goes?
I mean, that's a big advantage. I think, you know, getting in early is a big thing. We talk about it quite a bit on the show. You know, get in early. We talked about getting in betting on that hockey game today for tomorrow. I think that's a big thing. You know, as it gets closer to the game, the line is leveled out. So if you're ever looking for that little bit of edge, I mean, hey, just a couple percentage points here and there over a long haul, that definitely comes into advantage, comes into play, especially with so short margins as far. I mean, the best, you know, bettors in the world are not even over at 60%. So those extra couple percentage points here and there definitely helps your ROI on a long-term investment. But yeah, you know, Ryan, I used to like to go out to Vegas like a week or two before NFL started, and I'd bet a bunch of futures just so to give me a reason to come back, right? You know, when the season ended, you know, right when the season started, I thought, I can bet on this 10-1 odds, you know, bet $200. That's worth coming out to get $2,000, you know, come out to Vegas. But I haven't really had a chance to do that here recently. But yeah, I love getting in there and betting on, like, I got a few future bets on some of the baseball And, you know, watching that, it's a lot of fun. You get a lot of sweat equity out of it, you know, to bet early. You know, you get to sit on it all year, right?
Oh, so, God, yeah, it's so good.
For fun.
You are the man. Scotty G will be listening at 4:30. Woodward Betts got a whole crew over there, including the beer man, Chris Robin, and others.
Hey, one more. How about golf? How about the U.S. Open? Anybody stick out to you going forward here?
Yeah, we talked a little bit about that yesterday. Kelly came on, Kelly Singh in Phoenix, and she is our resident golf expert.
Yes,
and,
she is.
Yeah, I mean, she does pretty well. If you want, you guys can go back and check our show and run it down. She came on about 15 minutes in. And she broke it down pretty good, but she didn't agree with me. But I got Will Zalatoris to win. He's at 30-1. The last 6 out of 7 U.S. Opens have been won by somebody who has never won a major before. I think Zalatoris is ready. But she kind of warned me, you know, he's not very good at scrambling, and you got to be able to drive, you know, drive the ball pretty well. But, I mean, with this live tour going on, I think Rory's really motivated. She's a guy he liked. He's a guy she likes. So I think Rory, you know, is in the discussion. JT's in the discussion. But I'm going with Will Zalatoris. I think he's a guy that's going to be around for a long time. I think he's going to knock down a few majors in his career. So, hey, 30-1, why not? Let's roll.
Amen.
With it. I'm with Kelly. You have no idea.
Very good. Hey, Scotty G will be listening today, 4:30.
All right, guys. Appreciate you having me. We'll check you guys later.
My See you, man. Guys at Woodward Betts are on fire.
Fire.
Just like Marv Albert says. Guys, we got to take a break. Come right back. When we do, it's Maz's videos of the day. But first, a message from SMA.
SMA tackling the most important thing, and that is your mental health. And if you know somebody that struggles with mental health or any addiction, make sure they go to thesportsma.com right now and check out the podcast, This Is the F Word. It's all about fentanyl and how it's affecting our society today. So make sure you go right now, thesportsma.com.
Life is full of hard choices. We're here to make one of life's biggest decisions as simple as possible. My name is Christina Gennari, and for over 20 years, I've helped hundreds of families buy and sell homes. We cover all of Metro Detroit and more, from large luxury homes to starter homes. We will work hard to make sure that you get the home of your dreams. So if you're in the market today or even thinking about buying or selling in the future, make the obvious choice. Christina Gennari, the obvious choice in real estate. Visit us at soldchristina.com today.
Fellas, let's be honest. We like things to be easy. We like simple stuff, like sports 7 days a week. We like things uncomplicated, like Lady Jane's Haircuts for Men. Open 10 to 8, 7 days a week. Walk in anytime. Sign in, sit down, watch your favorite team play. And before you know it, your hair will be game ready. Open 10 to 8, 7 days a week. Walk in anytime. Lady Jane's Haircuts for Men. It's wicked awesome.
Woodward Avenue, the first paved road in America.
Woodward Sports,
the first sports network born in Detroit
and made for Detroit.
When you need apparel, there is only one. When you need apparel, there is only one place to go, Big Frog Novi. With no setup fees, no artwork fees, no minimum, and a 24-hour turnaround, you can have your whole team outfitted in no time. Embroidery, direct-to-garment, vinyl, and screen printing, Big Frog has the styles you want. Visit bigfrog.com/Novi or call 844-BIG-FROG. That's bigfrog.com/Novi.
All right, gang, it is that time of the day we like to play Maz's videos of the day.
And now it's time for Maz's videos of the day, only on the Woodward Sports Network.
All right, we got the NHL Corgi. You're going to love this one, Stick. The little dog that picks the winners of the Stanley Cup Final. We got to play it without the music, though.
I love this. I need to start doing this with Woody, man.
You good? You should.
I do. I'll do it tonight
for
the game.
You should. So let's check out the NHL Corgi. See who he picks to win the Stanley Cup Final. Here we go.
To the end zone.
I said we got to play it without the music. Here we go. Let's see.
That was game one. Game
let's
two.
Call it out.
Oh, get out of here.
What do we got so far?
Lightning. All right. He picked it to game one, right?
Okay.
Ooh.
What's he got for game two?
I love corgis.
Oh, get out of here. No way.
All right.
How has he made every basket?
Corgis are intelligent beings.
They're intelligent. So he's got the Lightning winning in six games.
That's about right. That's what I got him in.
So he's got the Lightning winning in six games. That is your NHL Corgi preview. Congratulations there. How about Shaq? We didn't talk about Shaq today. So tomorrow I'm going to bring that story back again.
Good for you.
And we're going to talk about fake Clay as well. We didn't talk about
fake Clay.
So can we talk about
fake seven.
Clay again tomorrow?
I'd like to.
Okay.
Banned for life, fake Clay.
We're going to talk about fake Clay because he's going to maybe be able to go to game seven.
Oh, he really?
Well, if we talk about him.
Oh, good.
Maybe
okay.
He'll be able to go to Clay.
If I was him,
seven.
I would sit courtside at Boston just to troll him.
There That's you right. go. So Shaq said he'd buy this kid a guitar if he did a duet with him.
Ooh.
So the kid said, all right. Let's try it. We
awesome.
Need volume. We actually need to hear.
Good job, Shaq.
That's
better
awesome.
Than Shaq.
Shaq is
national treasure.
He's the best.
Has there ever been a bigger guy more comfortable in his skin?
Like Charles
that's
what Barkley.
Makes Shaq. Santa, maybe? Santa Claus?
Yeah.
Santa
that's about
Claus.
It.
But that's what makes
Shaq
so special. Usually, like, seven-footers are just awkward dudes. But Shaq is – he's more comfortable in his skin than everybody I've ever seen in my life.
I love him. He could be my favorite guy.
Yeah.
He could be my favorite
guy. I had the Shaq sandals growing up from Reebok. I don't know if you guys remember those.
They had sandals?
They were, like, tennis shoes, but they were called sandals because they were – you had to, like, strap them on. But, yeah, it was –
Sweet.
It was wild, yeah. You could play basketball in them, but they were sandals. The Shaq sandals.
Wait till you watch Hustle, because the guy that's the star of this plays basketball.
Herman Goat?
Yep. He plays in construction boots, and that's how Adam Sandler says, whoa.
Yeah.
He says, wow, this kid could play in construction boots.
He could play with steel toes.
I found myself. I found myself the next one. This next one is, if you ever go to one of these drive-through safaris, I've been to many of them. This guy got himself a bunch of little bear cubs, and he got the high five with them.
Awesome.
Wow.
I love animals.
Look how sweet this
oh
is.
Oh, my gosh. No way.
Bears
how
are
sweet
people
is that?
In costumes, I'm convinced.
Is that not the sweetest thing you ever seen?
That is a human in a bear costume.
Get out of here.
Look at them cubs or bears.
Let's Get
see,
out of here.
Let's see that
here.
Again, Fletch.
Just
look at
up.
This guy.
Hey,
whoa.
High five. High five.
Bam.
The bear is as tentative as the human.
Dude, I would be too, man. I'm more scared of humans than bears.
Wow.
The other two said, nah, I ain't going there.
But I can't
did.
Believe they did that.
That's awesome. And it's dogs,
incredible.
Another one for Stick. I do this for you, Stick.
Thank you, buddy.
This is no dog left behind.
Oh.
So great. Let's see what happens.
Golden retrievers are awesome.
Oh, nice.
Oh,
no way.
Helps the homie.
How great is that?
Look at that. Huh?
The dogs are awesome.
Wait, let them
we don't deserve
door.
Dogs.
Look how great those
how
dogs are.
How great is that? Oh, my God.
That is the
That's
sweetest
sweet.
Animal.
That's a great video, Maz.
Thank you.
It's a great video today. Those are great videos today. Hey, by the way, I want to thank the people of Tuck Cummin.
Yeah.
Because they are on our ass.
They are.
Still?
I mean, oh, my God.
Still?
Well, Masalem.
They hate us.
Masalem tweeted out the video from the other day. And, I mean, they are just on our ass.
I replied.
Okay, so inside the locker room, ITLRS, Tuck Cummin continues to live rent-free. And then, you know, they play the clip of us saying, you know, yada, yada.
And it sticks me in the gut with a knife.
Yeah,
they
exactly.
They were loving it.
And then Mazawey says, just let me know when he's actually here. Is that the best response? I am going to use that response. Imitation is the sincerest form of flattery, Maz. And I hope you see it like that. I will absolutely love. To use that response.
My pleasure.
Well, that is the tricky part about that, you know, branding. Tuck Cummin. Eventually, Tuck got to arrive.
Yeah.
Like, and that's then you throw away all that branding. So I think Tuck's done a great job with branding, bringing, you know, a little bit of spice to this rivalry, and
he
I
has.
Love it.
He's a tough ass. No question.
He's tough. I
he's
like
a
him.
Tough
so
ass.
Good.
Like I said from the get-go, I would not mind him being my coach.
Amen to that. Hey, Stick, thanks so much for sitting in for Braylon today. Great job out of you.
Hey, I got to talk to Jim Leland today.
Three days this week.
Thank you, Stick.
Thank you so much. Maz, obviously. Sam Flannel, Fletch, great stuff. Hey. Guys, thank you. Like Woodward Sports, or subscribe to Woodward Sports. Like our show. Send it to a friend as well. Tell them about Woodward Sports. Let them know we're here because Woodward Sports coming.
Live tomorrow from Taylor on Telegraph.
Yep.
All three of our shows.
Come see us.
7 a.m. till 5.
Fish will be parading around as the big boy.
Come see us.
And don't forget Sean McDonough on The Bottom Line tomorrow.
And we'll see you tomorrow afternoon. Do I just go? I'm not going to drop.
Go.
All right. Go ahead.
2, 1.
Oh, my God.
Go.
Oh, geez. Oh, my. This isn't right. I don't get paid enough for this!